Good evening, everyone. My name is Jim Hirschfield. I'm the chairman of the Region 12 Board of Education. Thank you for coming to this Region 12 Board of Education special meeting, public forum, January 18, 2017. I will take attendance. Anthony Amato. Valerie Anderson.
Here.
Al Brown.
Here.
Greg Cava.
Here.
Rebecca Devine. Rebecca is going to be late. I think Anthony is going to be late as well. Michelle Gora.
Here.
I'm here. Stephanie Kolnick.
Here.
Jennifer Pody.
Here.
Lisa Roush.
Here.
Michael Sinatra.
Here.
Peter Tagley.
Here.
All right, so everyone is here except Anthony and Rebecca. And again, I think they're both going to be late. We also have with us tonight some invited guests, Mr. Ken Viega of ONG Industries, Gary Brochure, the board's attorney, and Ms. Jennifer Mangliangli, I'm sorry if I butchered her name, from Castle Booth Associates. So they'll be here. The purpose of this forum is to update the public on the status of this project. There has been changes to it. It is now on the state's new priority list, and we wanted to give the public opportunity to comment and ask questions, since there's sometimes more limited opportunities to do that at regular board meetings. So the way we'll do it tonight is there'll be a presentation first about the project, where it is as of right now, and then we'll open it up for questions or comments after that. So, Dr. Costantino.
Good evening, everyone. I'm glad so many people are able to come out. I just want to review the agenda with you so that you have it, so that you know what you're going to be hearing tonight. So first, Mrs. Gallo is just going to do a reminder of why Ag STEM. It's been so long. We want to make sure that everybody remembers. Talking about the journey so far, how we've gotten to this point. We will have an updated Ag STEM facility presentation, very small. Done a lot of work revising the facility, bringing a lot of the outdoor areas indoors using our footprint of Shepaug. Talking about Ag STEM enrollment, talking about Ag STEM financials, the Ag STEM business plan, and then question and answers. Okay, so we do have a list to sign up for questions. So if you want to speak, please make sure that you sign up with Debbie outside, and we'll be happy to answer your questions. So now Mrs. Gallo is going to come up and just remind us why Ag STEM.
Thank you, Dr. Costantino. I'm just as excited to report to you about this project as I was 2 years ago when we started this journey. First and foremost, the reason why we are benefiting our own children in this project is because we will take a robust learning environment and make it even more robust in terms of what we're able to offer of our students, what we're able to do in terms of making them college and career ready. Every student will be touched by this program every year. The way that we will do that, not every student will want to be in the program, but the way that we will do that is to create interdisciplinary opportunities so that our students who are in the typical classrooms can join with their agri-science counterparts and conduct experiments, conduct lectures, have rich discussion. Increased classroom discourse will happen in every classroom. We know that we're a small school. Sometimes when you're in a class of five people and you've known those five people your whole life, it doesn't make for a very exciting amount of discourse. Bringing new students, bringing new life into our building, brings new life into our classroom discourse. All of our school activities will be enhanced by a greater population. I talked about college and career pathways. Enhanced overall scheduling choices. For those of you who are parents, you know that at times in a small school, scheduling choices can be made very difficult when most of your courses are singleton courses, only one is offered. Larger school, more high school students creates more choices in our schedule. And obviously, when you look at the facility improvements that will come with this project, they are needed and they are necessary, and we look forward to them. as we look forward to this project. Thank you. Next, I'd like to talk to you about the proposed areas of study. We focus on four areas of study, and that is animal science, plant science, agricultural engineering, and agricultural production. Four areas. I'll talk about the first two first. Within animal science, there will be subjects such as veterinary science, equine science, and biotechnology, horticulture, natural resource management, sustainable food production, and landscaping and nursery management. What do we do with the resources of our world to create a better country, to create a better earth? Agricultural engineering takes a look at how these things are put together and how we make them work even better through mechanics, structural engineering, and energy management. And agricultural production is a very timely subject as we try to feed an ever-growing world, and that is through the production industry, nutrition, reproduction, products, and processing. And if you look at the graphic on employment opportunities and look at the opportunities that are happening in agri-science, you can see that there are rich opportunities for our students to become college and career ready in a variety of things. And what I always find most exciting and I love to talk about is the fact that most of the jobs that we're going to be preparing kids for don't even exist now. We're going to create a generation of explorers, of kids who problem solve, of students of intellectual curiosity that study these rich subjects. And now to talk about our journey is Dr. Cosentino.
I just wanted to let everyone know, we today put the PowerPoint on our website. So if you remember our beautiful AgriScience logo, if you open the website and you go down to the right, you'll see the logo. If you click on the logo, you can see the first link, and it's right there. So I know you have it, it's very small. We are trying to be careful about paper usage, but everything is on the website. So with that said, I just want to let you know how we got to this point. Our application was reviewed and accepted by the State Department of Education in the spring of 2015. The application was unanimously approved by the State Board of Education in August 2015. The referendum passed in all three towns, 1,663 to 757, November 2015. That was 69%. We thank you very much for your support. The project was delayed by the legislature, June 2016. And we have been working since then with DAS, the Department of Administrative Services, which handles school construction, to use more of our existing space, and you'll hear about that in a minute, to reduce our footprint by 17,195 square feet, which also reduced the cost more than $6.5 million. So with that said, Jen from Castle Booze is going to come up and just quickly show you the new plan for those of you who may not have seen the site.
Good evening. I'm excited to be here to share with you some of the updates, changes we've made to our site plan and floor plan. The updates have come from working closely with the administration here, as well as the advisory committee for the AgSTEM program, DAS, and their recommendations and help. So first, the site plan that we have to show you tonight, to orient you, north is up and the entrance is over here, the entrance drive to the building. Because of the expanded students that will be occupying the school, the main parking area and drop-off will be expanded and improved to facilitate new students, more buses, etc. We have located the main additions for the AgriScience STEM Academy towards the north end, of the building. And primarily, that was a result of utilizing this green area that's existing in the building now. That's some current tech ed spaces and some underutilized square footage in the facility. Utilizing that green area and renovating it for these Ag STEM program areas, we were able to build less new construction and alter a footprint that we already have to keep some of the Ag STEM contained together. There is an addition for some of the spaces that didn't fit so well inside of the building because we didn't have enough square footage inside, and because the nature of the spaces required greater ceiling heights than we had available, and so on. So there is an addition to the north as well. There is a standalone facility left in this project. However, before, if you had seen the site plan previously, we had a few standalone buildings that were new construction. We were able to reduce and consolidate, right size things, look again at numbers, and we have now ended up with one standalone facility, and that will be the animal demonstration and garage building. That would house the cows, horses, pigs, some of those larger animals would be in that area, and be a learning and instruction space for students, as well as a garage that needs to handle some of the special equipment that this Ag STEM program needs. There's also outdoor facilities associated with that garage and animal building, such as an outdoor riding area, paddock, pastures. At the far end of the building, the south end, are the existing science rooms now, which are planned to be renovated as a separate grant project. We're going to locate in that area, when we are able to reconfigure and renovate, we'll be locating a couple of our Ag STEM plant science rooms down to that location in the existing footprint, which is also shown in green. And in addition, for greenhouses to support the plant science program. That south end gives us the capability of having some growing areas too. South end of the building, which makes sense, and away from some of the traffic and activity going up further north. Yeah, sure. This is the floor plan, which just is in a little greater detail than the site plan showed previously. The green area, again, is towards the north of the building to renovate existing underutilized space. By doing that, we actually increased alterations by about 8,500 square feet. But we reduce new construction, which is in blue, the addition in the north, the animal demonstration and garage, and the greenhouse addition. Those have actually, all in all, we've lost 25,000 square feet of new construction. So as that turns out, we're down 17,000 square feet, all in all, from where we were before. Okay, and these are just details of some of those spaces that we've worked out with everyone.
Mr. Cobb is going to come up.
Good evening. The slide you see now represents the, let's make sure it's the slide, I think it is, represents the revisions to the project that has been reviewed and approved by DAS for inclusion on the state priority list. You can see that the total square footage under the original ED049, which was the original one submitted, was 73,000 square feet. That has now, under the revised version, been reduced to 56,305, which is a net reduction of 17,195 feet. The total cost has gone from the original, this is just for the Ag STEM portion, the original $36,513,900 to $29,957,400, and that's a reduction of $6,556,005. The total projected enrollment, as you can see, has been reduced, the enrollment on which we're basing this has been reduced from 240 to 139 students. The next slide.
Exactly.
is again a summary of the project financing. You're going to see a total financing of $36,513, and in the original format, that went to $26,200,000 from the state with local funding of $10,245,000, call it $10,246,000. Under the new, the current, most recent proposal that's been approved is on the list for DAS for funding. It's a total financing of $29,957,400 for AgSTEM. You'll see progress payments from the state grant of $23,966,000, call it. And that's local funding has been reduced from the $10,245,000 to $5,991,482,000, just under $6 million. And that is a reduction of $4,254,000, as was originally proposed to come from the three towns of Roxbury, Bridgewater, and Washington. Final slide that I'm going to talk about is the you basically have a cost breakdown here. Again, it summarizes the costs: $29,900, state share is $23,900, the local share is $5,900,000. If you add in the debt and interest payments, in other words, the debt payments, that brings that $5,900,000 to $8,000,000, and that's what's payable over 20 years at the estimated rate of 3.25%. As you can see, the two pie charts below it, you've got the local share and the state share of AgSTEM. The local share is, our share is 20%. The state picks up 80% of it. And the other chart shows you the breakdown by towns. The other pie chart shows you the breakdown by towns. Washington picks up 48.5%, or $3.9 million. That's of the $8 million. Roxbury's share, 32%, is $2.6 million, and Bridgewater's 19.5% share is $1.5 million. So you can see what each town's long-term, over 20-year gross amount of the project would be, grossed up by debt, and net any other income. Gross of any other income, I'm sorry. All right, I'd like to introduce Ms. Gallo, who's going to talk about enrollment projections.
The next thing I'd like to talk to you about is where these students are going to come from. And that has created a lot of questions, and I'd like to be as clear and concise as I can be. And also to talk to you about the confidence with which I present these numbers. If you look at the graphic above, ASTE is a state abbreviation, and it stands for Agriscience, Science, and Technology. That is a state term. So when you hear ASTE, which is how it's called at the state, that's what we're talking about. When we talk about projections for grades 9 through 12, the blue circle represents the unmet need that has occurred over the last 4 years. Let me tell you what that means. Over the last 4 years, 66 students have been turned down by non-WAG in the towns that we have signed agreements for. I'm not including Bethel in this. And we're capping the Danbury, as we've agreed to, at 4 students per year. So 66 students are the pool from which we would draw the additional students that we would need for our program. There are 78 students currently sitting in the seat, if you look at the bar all the way over to your left. When you look at the little sliver that says 4, that is the additional Region 12 students that we can expect, because they will now be hometown students. They will be students that are signing up in their own school. And we're using 15%, which is a conservative estimate of students that we will find that will have interest in this program and signing up for the program. The 102 is at the very bottom of the range that we have discussed, and that represents the three-year average of these communities, how many students have they sent over the last 3 years, plus one more, with the exception of Danbury. That's the agreements to which they sign, is three-year average plus one. We know that we can do better, and this pie chart shows you that. The little red slice talks about students who may be admitted, but they decline admission. So we don't count all of the students in that circle. That little red slice are the ones that sign up, apply, are accepted, and say, and change their minds, as we know that young students can do. So that 102 represents a baseline. Where do we go to get from the 102 to the 122 that we have previously presented to the 139, which is the number that the board agreed upon? And why are we confident with that 139? That's information that you should have. Additional growth from the wait list represents a slice of that that you see. Thank you, Pat. And then we can talk about the additional demand that is created in these six schools. For instance, we are currently in negotiations with Bethel that would create more students that would come to our school. It makes sense for them to come here for many reasons, and we had a very good presentation with them. Right now, there's a Danbury cap of 4 students per year. We know that that's a flexible number, and the reason why we know, it's not anecdotal, it's because right now, in Region 14, 19 students sit in those seats. They are registered students in the Nanawag program. That is in excess of the cap already. So we have every reason to believe that is flexible. Now I'll go into some more reasons. First of all, I'd like to break down for you the applications. This is a longitudinal view of student interest. And what I'd like to bring to your attention when you look at this, it's each community, how many ninth graders applied, and it takes you on a longitudinal walk from the school year 2010-2011 all the way to 2016-17. And remember, for the 119 out-of-district students, we would need to make our promise of 139 students, we would need 30 out-of-district students per year. And as you can see, if you leave Bethel out, that's the first total line. In the last 4 years, there have been an unmet need of 26, 26, 34, and now 45 students. As we've begun to talk about this program, it has already created greater interest in the Region 14 program that currently exists, in the population from which we will draw our students. I also want to make sure that we have some clarity to this discussion through common language. When we talk about applications, that is from the Region 14 report that comes out each year internally that tracks the number of applications, the number of students who were accepted, and the number of students who were waitlisted, which represents the unmet need. That's applications. Acceptances, obviously, that's the number of students that are accepted by the school. Our enrollment figures come from the October 1st report to the State Department of Education. On October 1st, every school counts their students and sends a report to the state. So our enrollment figures come directly from those state reports. And the admittance rate, obviously, is going to be the number of accepted students divided by the number of applications and allow us to arrive at a percentage. And the yield rate, which is a very important rate, is the number of students enrolled divided by the number of acceptance to arrive at a percentage. As we go to the next page, I'll just quickly show you, and those of you that are very, very interested in these numbers are welcome to look at this piece on the network. However, Stanford University, if we looked at their admittance rate of 5%, we would think things were pretty dismal at Stanford. However, the yield rate, those who are accepted, nearly 80% of them attend. We took a very conservative year at Region 14, and we looked at how many students applied, accepted, their admittance rate was 71%, and their yield rate was 56.3%. If you go to the next slide, again, applications, acceptances, enrollment, what does it show? You are looking at from 2010-2011, straight through to 2016-17. What does the admittance rate look like at Region 14, and what does the yield rate look like? Sometimes the yield rate is greater than 100%. Why is that? That shows you the strength of the wait list. When students decline, you go to the waitlist, and you get more students. These schools only represent those schools with which we have signed agreements. Lastly, I'd like to just elaborate a bit on how we can be confident that we can increase enrollment, because I think you should know what that looks like. Our Shepaug Hometown Advantage will encourage more students to be in this program. We've looked at a very conservative 15% of students. Perhaps we can do better, but 15% is a very reasonable number. Our strong relationship with Sherman has yielded many more Sherman students in recent years. This year, 15 Sherman freshmen entered Shepaug. That strong relationship almost puts Sherman at the hometown level along with Shepaug. They consider that strong relationship, and they'll consider this program, and it's not as big of a move as it is for other students when they go to a different school. Marketing and recruitment is something we have absolute control over. At this time, because Region 14 turns down nearly half of the students that apply, they do not do a strong marketing and recruitment program. As educators, why on earth would we recruit more kids just to turn them down? It doesn't make sense. It makes perfect sense once we have reasonable catchment areas for Region 14 and for the Shepaug Agri-Science program. So we will conduct a rigorous marketing and recruitment program each year to take that unmet need, to take the number of applications, and to increase that number so that we have a good pool of candidates from which we can choose. Our sending town agreements are firm, and we have good relationships with each of these school districts, and they continue to work closely with us as this program progresses. The things on the other side of the aisle are things that we don't have as much control over, but I should mention them to you. The Bethel agreement is not in our pocket, and I'm very honest with you when I say that. However, we have good reason to believe that Bethel will join with us for reasons of transportation, reasons such as having a strong program, having a new program. The presentation that we made in Bethel went very well, and we anticipate hearing from them positively in the near future. The Danbury cap, again, as I said, is flexible, and we know that it's flexible because it's exceeded right now by the October 1st report at the State Department of Education. Proximity is something that is very hard to put your hands on, but when we build a program that is closer to some of these communities, it is more attractive to students in those communities. If you live closer to us than you do to Woodbury, you're more likely to come here. And if you look geographically at Nanawag's acceptances, you will see that as well. And the wait list, the unmet need that exists right now, is something we can expand upon, we can recruit, and we can welcome other students from other communities to create a more robust high school. Shepaug is a wonderful school, and it's a great place to welcome our kids. Now for the financials. I'm running away.
Hi, I'm Valerie Anderson. Am I speaking too loudly?
I think so.
I'm treasurer and finance chair, and I'm going to present meat and potatoes. Why is the number 139 so very important? 139 of the students that we hope to have in our program. It's a conservative number. It's been derived through great experience and a very conservative approach. And that's our revenue. That's what's going to cover our expenses to operate this program, to give a robust program not only to our students but others in the area, even reaching beyond Litchfield County, going into New Haven County, and Fairfield County. And our goal with these 139 children, as they come to us, and of course our kids are part of that number, some of our kids, is to provide this robust program for the entirety of the Shepaug community, and to make sure income, as much as we can, covers our operating expenses, so that we are budget neutral. And that also the program is debt neutral. And I'll get into those statistics in just a moment. I do want to thank a lot of people in this community for their help. Sometimes it's a little frustrating, but in helping us sharpen our pencils, look at the numbers, debate our numbers, question our numbers, so what we're presenting to you is comes from great experience and great, I think, due diligence. So, slide 19 is based on the proposition that we have as few as 102 kids coming in the next 20 years. And as a result, you see we do run a deficit. And in fact, that deficit at the very end of the day is something like $9 million. That would be in year 2039, 2040. That does not take into consideration a $1 million gift that this school system has been told we will receive as a imprimatur, if you will, of what these people think is a great AgSTEM program. More about that in a minute. So then we go to 122 kids and what that income looks like. And if you take a look at the column, revenue versus our best guesstimate of operating cost associated with that AgSTEM, and then throw in the debt. Yes, indeed, we do run a deficit. You go to 139, which we do believe to be a highly conservative number, but a little more realistic if you're talking 20 years out. At the end of 20 years, all in, no change whatsoever in enrollment, staying at 139, we will see an operating deficit of about $2 million. That includes debt service. That is what we think is a very conservative number on revenue, 139 kids, a very conservative operating expense, which includes inflation and increases over time, plus debt service. That does not include, once again, the $1 million of grant money, a gift, that we will be getting from private donor that might offset this the individual cost that we have here to establish the program. This slide, are we on 22 or 23? 22. This shows in a graphic way what our revenue is, stable, 139, that is the green line, versus our rising expenses in running the program. Bob Giesen developed these numbers based on his own, I think, great, conservative, experienced calculation, and in which you see, of course, operating expenses will go up. But once again, we have not done anything on the revenue side. The next slide, 23. I'm moving along.
Good.
Adds in debt service for the AgSTEM. And you see that the green bar, revenue, matches for many years our operating expenses and the debt service associated with the program. It isn't until much, much later in year 18, 19, 20 that you see indeed an increase that offsets the revenue, but we do believe we will increase our revenue by that time. What I think is a far more important piece of paper is a schedule that was put together by Bob. I think you have copies.
I have the last one, right?
Yeah, sorry, I'm jumping ahead.
Okay.
One of our goals is to always have revenue cover operating expenses of the program. But an additional goal is to have revenue cover operating expenses of the program plus debt service. That's a mighty big challenge. But because of what I think is expert handling of our present debt, which falls off in the year 2018, we pay about $460,000 a year in debt service right now. And that debt will be fully paid and fall off our operating budget that you all vote for in 2018. What we've been able to do is make it budget neutral when we take on this additional debt. We will get revenue and we will smooth out increases in debt. And if you take a look at this particular chart, If you see the year 2022.
Where is that original chart?
We're making copies right now.
Oh, okay, thank you.
You'll get it shortly, sorry. But I think this is better than the bar graph. So in the year 2022, what is our normal debt that we pay, just like your mortgage, is about $450 a year. That jumps in that one year of 2022, a gradual increase, to a total high of $624,000 to pay for this program, existing debt, which will be sliding off, and will be basically budget neutral. So you're not going to see a massive jump in your property tax, in your mill rate. The operating budget, we hope, will be as level as it can be, so you will not find big impact in every year when you vote for our budget in May. That's our hope, that's our commitment. And indeed, that does not take into consideration that $1 million gift that will be part of our program, not used necessarily for debt service, but used to offset expenses. Once again, the goal is have the program pay for its operating expenses and have the operating budget as level as possible to include debt, so there's no huge impact on us as taxpayers. And then at the end of the day, we have a robust program. We put the pin in the map so that we are basically a magnet school for the state, and we survive. Because all this is about unmet need and wanting to increase population here. And I do believe that we're back to 24. 24 is the impact of Ag STEM and the science labs put together, which is also another important statistic. I'm basically focusing on Ag STEM and how we pay for it and how it will affect the budget. Remember, we have to build labs too. It's part of our accreditation with NEASC. Our deficiency was that we need new science labs. That was part of the referendum. So if you throw that in, you will see that we have total existing debt going down over time after reaching a peak in the year 21-22. Our commitment is to level out debt service for all debt, budget neutral. And we think we can do that, particularly with the revenue coming in from the Ag STEM tuition. So, we're projecting a conservative 139 kids. We've taken only 139 kids as our revenue source over 20 years. No one can argue that's not the most conservative approach. The revenue will cover the operating expenses, excluding debt. But with debt included, we will have a shortfall over 20 years, but we will manage our debt, our existing debt, and the debt we take on to make it as budget neutral as possible, flat. The total debt, which includes interest, is $8,297,000 over the entirety of 20 years. And we have that donation of $1 million that we're just going to hold in our back pocket and be thankful for, but might be used to offset expenses, likely will. We do look forward to the state on occasion awarding grants on a yearly basis as time goes over to cover improvements to that program, the Ag STEM program. The Science Lab project is not included in the Ag STEM model for the most part. The local share of this project is approximately $2 million, and that principal plus interest is $2.6 million. It's best that both projects be done together. It will save us a lot of money. Some project it'll save us about $2 million to get these labs done at the same time that we build the Ag STEM. Also, we are in an aging facility. So a lot of what we're going to do for the Ag STEM program is the normal capital expenditures we likely would have faced over time anyway. So a lot of those projects will be taken care of sooner and with state money instead of overtime and with less state money offsetting our expenses. So I think our entire bonding position will be a lot better. That's it.
Thank you, Val.
I just want to go through the next steps. On Monday evening, well, first of all, we'll have tonight questions and answers. Monday evening, the Board of Education will have on the agenda to move to continue working with Castle Blues and ONG with the project. By February 1st, DAS will be with the Legislative School Construction Committee to review our project again, and that is based on a letter that went from OPM to look at our project again. Hopefully our project moves forward after that review. The project then goes to the Education and the Finance, Revenue, and Bonding Committees at the state. Their deadline is March 27, 2017 for the bill to be voted out of the committee. It then moves through the legislative process. The Board of Education is moving offices, so I couldn't get exact dates after this, but after that it goes to the Appropriations Committee, where they must vote on the bill, but they can also amend it. After that, the bill goes, if it makes it out of appropriations, it goes to the floor of the Senate and then the House for approval. If it makes it through that, it then goes to legislative approval to send the project to the governor for signature. And then after that, the project goes to the bonding commission to be funded. With that said, I just want to take a quick second to thank my staff, especially Mrs. Gallo, Mr. Giesen, many of the board members, Mrs. Gora, Mrs. Anderson, Mr. Amato, worked very hard to put this presentation together. I also want to remind everyone that this is a very flexible kind of presentation. It's very hard to pinpoint when you are talking 2 years to an opening and 20 years. What I will tell you is that we were very conservative with our 139 students. When you look at some of the different proposals and scenarios, we did not raise any students. We didn't raise tuition, revenue, anything. We did raise costs with inflation, 2.5 for operating costs and 6% for medical. So we only did that on one side. And I just want to thank the staff. They really did work very hard. And at this point, I'm going to introduce our chairman, who has the lists of people, and will ask you to speak at that microphone when your name is called.
All right. It's now time for folks to either make comments or ask questions. We'll do the best we can to answer them. We've asked people to sign a list, and I will call the names on the list. Right now, I've got 48 people on the list. I'm going to hold people to 3 minutes or thereabouts. And so if everybody goes for 3 minutes, we'll only be here for 2.5 hours. So you're welcome to say. So we'll start and try to get through this as quickly as we can. Joan Lodes, if you would go to the microphone. And this is Joan Lodes from Washington.
Jimmy took my first line. My name is Joan Lodes and I live in Washington. First, I would like to thank the members of the Board of Education for their willingness to serve on this board. Most, if not all of us, know the amount of time and dedication it takes to perform your duties as a Board of Ed member. I understand you are all volunteers and receive no money for the hours you spend on your work on the board. This fact does not in any way minimize your fiduciary responsibility to the taxpayers of Bridgewater, Roxbury, and Washington. At a recent Board of Ed meeting on January 9, 2017, You had a vote on whether to pay bills of $135,000 to Castle Booze and O&G Industries. Quite correctly, you voted unanimously to pay the bills because the work had already been done. However, going back in August of 2016, the full Board of Education authorized the building committee to spend up to $30,000. The building committee requested and received an estimate for work to be done of $10,000. The building committee then authorized the expenditure of $10,000. There was no further authorization to spend any money. Based on this, money spent without authorization is $125,000. It is incomprehensible to believe that members of the administration or the Board of Education think this is an acceptable way to do business. Someone asked for the work to be done, knowing very well that the spending had not been authorized. That person needs to be identified and held responsible. One conclusion at the meeting appeared to be a shrug of the shoulders and a statement that someone dropped the ball on this one. Some attempted to blame the error on Charlie. I didn't know at the time who Charlie was, but I do now, and he is not a member of the staff at Region 12, nor is he a member of the Board of Education. So he has no fiduciary responsibility to Region 12. I would suggest to you that no one dropped the ball, but rather a person or persons picked up the ball and ran with it. It is clear to me and many others that the administration, perhaps encouraged by one or two members of the board, long ago decided that ASTE is so important to them that they would use any means necessary to make it happen. Now we can add the expenditure of more than $100,000 in unauthorized funds. My question is, will somebody be held responsible for this?
I think it was explained at the meeting that the administration's goal at the time was to get us on the priority list for the state on December 15th, and that the spending authorization that had been passed by the board was not adhered to. And so I think that the person responsible, Dr. Costantino, took responsibility for that. And so that's the answer to your question.
Thank you, Jim. I don't feel it's an answer.
Thank you. Next is Ned Bandler from Bridgewater.
My name is Ned Bandler. I'm a 24-year resident of Bridgewater. I've served as chairman of the Board of Trustees of Bridgewater. My background is corporate finance, marketing, and public relations. There are two reasons that I want to speak tonight. The first, as a graduate of Cornell University College of Agriculture and Life Sciences, I have followed this project from the beginning and have followed the dramatic evolution in agricultural training and agricultural employment over this period. I have the belief, and I know that belief is shared by others, that this is genuinely a vocational agriculture program, and the AgSTEM label is a public relations facade that is not fair to the people who graduate and have to find jobs in the real agricultural science and technology businesses today. The second concern I have as a citizen is that I believe the way the referendum was conducted, it did not meet the obligation that we have to the public to provide all the facts and all the consequences of a project. We are very fortunate that this was not an SEC filing because it was so lacking in some of the substantial facts. We now are at a point where there have been significant changes since that referendum. And I'm not going to join in the local and national prospect of raising whether or not, as presented, it was legitimate. But I do think there is a compelling reason to alter the course we are on. There is no dishonor in looking at the new facts in Connecticut, a state that is 50 out of 50, and where the financial crisis is going to impact every small town in Connecticut. The fact is that the numbers that were presented initially on enrollment were not produced in what many of us believe was a professionally careful, responsible, and accurate way. And I think public trust has waned as to the second presentation. This is a country where we believe in second chances. And the board has a second chance to take a look at this again and take into account the changes in finances that have overwhelmed our state and will have impact on our state. The second thing is that we are all entitled to our opinions, but not to our facts. So I have to pay tribute to a dedicated group of concerned citizens in Washington, Roxbury, and Bridgewater, who has spent an enormous amount of time in probing the real, or as we say in the South, the true facts of this, and we believe they deserve a respectful hearing from the Board of Education. If Winston Churchill were with us today, he would give us his favorite saying, "Facts are better than dreams."
Thank you. Next is Valerie Friedman from Washington. That was almost 5 minutes, so please try to keep it to 3 minutes, please. We've got a lot of people who want to speak.
You spent 46 minutes selling the project. We can get a little time here.
Thank you. Valerie Friedman?
Me. My name is Valerie Friedman, and I live in Washington. I make my living in the financial arena, devoting my professional skills to helping clients minimize risks. I make my living in the financial arena, devoting my professional skills to helping clients minimize risks that would undermine their financial security. So when I review the proposal for the VOAG program, I see daunting financial risks to the taxpayers of Region 12, which will negatively impact the educational future of all of the children in the region. It's difficult to understand how this board and administration could not be aware of these risks. Plunging ahead, arguing that a referendum based on faulty information given to the public represents a mandate is just another example of this dangerous thinking that will put the region and its taxpayers at risk. Just 5 of our own children per year, or 20 in all, would actually be VOAG students. So this is not really about educating our students, but about creating a business model with hopes of ensuring the survival of Region 12. There has never been an objective, independent review of the financial projections by an experienced business consultant for this now $30 million plan. Instead, the board chose to spend $50,000 of taxpayer monies on a public relations consultant to sell the project to the public. The result has been ongoing revisions due to input from this group of questioning citizens, as the overly optimistic enrollment and spending projections have proven to be poorly developed and constantly revised downward. My question to the board is this: have you adequately considered these financial risks and shared them with the public? We have no evidence that you have. Some of these risks include revenue that is significantly short of projections, if even these lowered enrollment forecasts continue to be too optimistic, which several of us believe they are. Building costs that exceed the budget, expenses that are higher than projected, and then given the state's serious financial situation, subsidies as the state pays Region 12 for each VOAG student continue to be reduced and may disappear entirely. Tuition payable for the students coming from other towns could also be reduced, as has already been predicted. And what people don't seem aware of is what is known as the clawback provision. If the VOAG program fails within 20 years, the region's taxpayers are obligated to repay the state a prorated portion of the $24 million state grant. And then I think it's a little misleading in the presentation I heard this morning, this afternoon. The VOAG program must be run separately from the high school to meet state requirements. Classes are not open to students who are not enrolled in the VOAG curriculum. So in closing, let me quote from a letter sent by Ben Barnes, Secretary of the State of Office of Policy and Management in Hartford, to members of the State School Construction Committee on December 29th of 2016. The state's portion of the grant, $24 million, and this is the quote, amounts to $172,417 per student. The highest projected enrollment has declined by 101 students. I urge you, he said, review this project carefully, including how the agri-science needs are currently met before acting on it. So I ask the school board and administration to follow up on what was just said by Ned. Reconsider what has been demonstrated to be a flawed approach to saving our high school and the future of Region 12, and to consider more prudent alternatives that will benefit all of our students.
Thank you. I will note that Mr. Barnes's daughter is participates in an ACSTEM program, so I know that he believes in that. Next is Karen Buell from Marbledale.
Just the bottom line. Karen, I'm sorry. Can you hear me? I've had three children graduate from Shepaug, 2013, 2014, 2015, and I have one in elementary school. I'm very concerned about the future for all of the Region 12 children. The ACSTEM program is a wonderful asset for some children, but when I read in the paper that general classes cannot use the ACSTEM programs according to state statute, how is that helping our students? When I come across a YouTube video done on November 8th telling us that they've revised the blueprint for the ACSTEM and the general students have lost woodworking, auto, and drafting classrooms, how is this helping Region 12 students? These trades are very important for our children to learn. I started doing some research online on our ACSTEM program, found documents as a parent of a general student I was ashamed to find. As you know, the science labs have been in disarray for years, and it's my understanding that we will lose our accreditation if they're not upgraded. To read in these documents that the benefits to general ed students is an upgraded science lab, a new parking lot, and an entrance, really? I've read that children from our region will have to apply to the VOAG program, but they're not telling anyone about the tuition costs for the general ed students. I've heard about leasing horse stalls, but I have found documents saying that if we do, we'll have to pay back the grants. I'm concerned about the opportunities for general students in our region. I want to know what's going to make our children stand out to colleges. What about the children who want to learn trades such as woodworking and being a mechanic? And I hope you don't say they need to go out of district because we currently have these at Shepaug. When I asked my three older children what was the best thing about going to Shepaug, one answered auto class and the other two said block scheduling. What a shame for our students to have lost both of these. I also have one son who's asthmatic, who was around hay one day and got farmer's lung. He spent a week in the intensive care unit. What measures are going to be in place to protect the general students from cross-contamination in the classrooms and hallways? In closing, this new revised ACSTEM program is not what I voted for. And as a taxpayer, I think $40 million is a very large price tag to educate children from other towns.
All right, thank you. Next is John Boniuto from Washington.
John Boniuto from Washington. Just a few fact checks. To follow up on Joan Lotson's comment about the $105,000 being billed out without authorization. And the superintendent's explanation that she was in a rush to get it on the 2017 priority list. I do know that at the end of the legislative session, when the appropriations were not granted by the state legislature, that DAS Commissioner Curry sent a letter to the Region 12 Board and Dr. Cosentino stating, do not worry, it's already on the list for 2017. So I do realize there was some downsizing, but to use the excuse that it was not on the list is incorrect. It was on the list. Number two, you talk about Bethel potentially coming on board. Unfortunately, in the Bethel Board of Ed minutes from June 24th, 2016, Dr. Carver, in agenda item number three, BOAG discussion, states, and she informed the committee that the Connecticut General Statute 10-6410-65 required the local boards of education, the local Bethel Board of Education, to designate a BOAG program in the district if they do not offer one. Also, the district can cap the amount of students that can attend such a program at least equal to the average of students over the last 3 years. Many of our surrounding communities have created a cap. She noted that expenses associated with BOAG programs include transportation costs, which the district is required to provide, and tuitions. The committee discussed the need to designate a school and a cap for the amount of students which attend such a program. Currently, Bethel sends 8, so I can assume that their Board of Education will cap at 8.
That's 3 minutes.
In addition, a lot of the schools, that's the problem. They have their education budget to shore up. When they are faced with additional costs to transport and pay tuition, that is going to be a limiting cap, basically. They're not going to send many more than they currently send. And even if they do, it's just a willingness to increase the number that they already send. It's not a guarantee.
Mr. Boniuto, that's 5 minutes. Please, we need to move on.
The science lab costs were...
Mr. Boniuto, would you please? It's been 5 minutes. Next is Janet Boniuto, Washington.
How about a timer? Someone in front can keep
I've got
a
watch here. I'm trying to be reasonable. 5 minutes, we've got a lot of people.
Janet Boniuto, Washington. To be quick, if you could go back to slide number 16, you talk about applications, acceptances, enrollment, what does it show? You talk about a yield rate. The 2 years where you have above 100% yield rate, you have applications at 1 year is 26, acceptances at 10, and the enrollment at 12. Obviously, there's something wrong. You can't have accepted at 10 and then enrolled at 12. So I think there's something wrong with this slide that you have presented to the public. I'm going to get on to my main topic. Concerning the wait list, much has been made of the stated 50 to 60 student wait list reported from Nanawag's BOAG. On these numbers, Region 12 is basing the need for a new agri-science program. Through the Freedom of Information, we have learned that Nanawag's reported wait list is actually the number of students that are not initially accepted when decisions are made in February for the coming year. That number is greatly reduced as accepted students either change their mind or for various other reasons decline their enrollment, decline to come. For example, I received an actual waitlist from Newtown that shows 4 students placed on the waitlist in February. Eventually, two of those students were offered acceptance, and the parent of one student declined to send. What was once a list of four quickly became a list of one on the wait list. Concerning out-of-district enrollment from our six sending towns, there has been an enormous amount of misinformation put forth in the past. This prompted me to request through Freedom of Information details concerning the present enrollment in Nanawag's Ag Science program. My questions included how many students from each school are presently attending Region 14 for this particular year. I asked them to break down the number by grade, and I asked how many of the students were placed on a wait list. The total number reported by these sending towns is 57 students. This includes Danbury's cap of 15. There was a total of 8 students placed on the wait list. Keep in mind that the sending towns never agreed to send the wait list, which might be increased with aggressive recruiting. They simply agreed to increase above their 3-year average, the number they currently support in Region 14. This could mean 1 above, 4 above, any number of possibilities. It's interesting to note that Brookfield Superintendent John Burrill added to his signed agreement, to the extent that additional Brookfield students are interested in such a program. These agreements are no guarantee of student applications or enrollment. So we really have no idea what the increase will be over 57 students. I would urge every one of our Board of Education members to please call these sending towns. There's only 5 of them. If you're going on the 139 number, you subtract the 20 students from Region 12 and the cap of Danbury at 15, you have 104 students to go between, to be averaged between 5 other towns. So please call Brookfield and ask if they will send 14 more than their current 6. Call New Fairfield and ask if they will send 15 more than their current 5. Query Newtown and ask if they plan on sending 11 more than their current 9. New Milford is already sending 20 students, so I don't think you need to call them. But please call Sherman and ask them if they are willing to send 18 above their current enrollment of 2 students. We need to know realistically what we can expect from these sending towns. We don't have to make a guess. You can call. Dr. Cosentino did not want to call these sending towns. I ask that you please do. It's your responsibility to our region, to our towns, and to our students. This whole program could literally bankrupt our school system. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Jay Cronfeld from Roxbury.
Okay, good. I have a lot of problems with the data that has been described tonight. It's the same problem that was described back in October of 2015. I'll talk to the numbers of people who cast their ballot first on that referendum. Approximately a little over 2,400 people cast their ballots. 1,600 plus were in favor, 700 plus were against it. Those numbers represent only 45% of the total electorate. Now, when you think about when this process was constructed, it was 1 week after the general election. Most people thought that their civic duty was over and they went about their business. I would suggest that and challenge the board to have a new referendum on this subject. Secondly, with respect to the numbers that were presented tonight, the low number of 122 is roughly one half, 50% of what you first came up with. The numbers are still suspect. Having gone over many of these numbers and looking at what the current numbers are in your data does not correct for kids that drop out or the reduction in the total number of student population over the next several years that the Department of Education has put forward. I would suggest that Mr. Kavas, since he presented the numbers on bonding and that percentage, if this project were to go forward, only covers the risk to the towns for the bond, the portion of the bond that they would have to pay. However, if this project fails, which it will, because the real numbers are probably not more than 70 kids when you correct for dropouts, when you correct for reduction in population, is huge. The electorate will demand that this thing get closed. We'll probably lose Region 12 High School, and the bond, the total $30 million, which is the real risk, will fall to the people of Region 12. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Howard Barnett of Washington.
The issue all of us are addressing is not whether we're for or not whether we're for or against education or for or against this community or for or against children. The question is far more practical. Will the ASD plan proposed by the board work in the way that has been promoted? And in order for it to be a success educationally and financially, as I think Valerie just said, we'll need first and foremost students in the seats with all the revenue that we hope they bring. If real estate is about location, 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 it seems to me this plan is about enrollment, enrollment, enrollment. The administration and the board originally forecast 236 students. Then last year they told the State Department of Education 139. No matter how many times the board utters the word conservative about the 139, it just isn't so. Only recently has the board even begun to recognize that there are two major difficulties that we face in actually getting students in the seats. One is the lack of sufficient student demand for VOAG. And my friend Janet Bonaiuto has spoken to that. But the board continues to overstate demand, in part due to a fundamental misunderstanding of non-OAGs or really any school's admission process. When you take a kid off the wait list, acceptances have gone up, yield has gone down. This chart doesn't recognize that. It also means that the wait list has shrunk, which means unmet demand has shrunk. It seems to me that the entire presentation ignores those fundamental facts. The other problem concerns the reluctance of our sister school district to send us students, as was also mentioned, even if the students might like to come. Bear in mind that most of the towns in the area have the same problems we do, starting with declining student population. They want to hold on to their students and hold on to their schools just like we do. Their boards of education have their own parent bodies to answer to. These schools have their own fixed expenses to cover and their own teachers' salaries to pay. All this will make them very reluctant to send us many students. Sending them to us leaves them with empty seats and costs them almost $7,000 in annual tuition, plus transportation costs. And then there's the fact that was not explained at the time of the referendum, that the schools in our catchment area don't have to send us every student who expresses an interest in ASD. In the interest of time, I won't get into it, but it was discussed a little bit that the law allows them to cap their obligation to send us ASD students, and as we know, they all have. Danbury, from whom we were once told to expect 60 students, now say not more than 15, and the other towns have similarly capped their obligation. So even giving ourselves the benefit of all doubt, the highest possible cap for all six sending towns, including Danbury, is around 80 students. So That's 80, not 196, not even 119, and 80. And of course, it could be lower depending on how you interpret the terms of these agreements. Now, I guess we would all like to think that the towns will ignore their own caps, and we can dream. But they established the caps for the very understandable purpose of protecting their own school systems. I believe we ignore them at our own great risk. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Jim McNulty from Bridgewater.
My name is Jim McNulty, I live in Bridgewater, and I would like to compliment the board and all of the members on the quality of the presentation. It is done well, it's done professionally, and it was delivered very smoothly. The same kind of an approach was taken when I saw the presentation prior to the referendum, and at the same time, if we were back there, I would have been saying the same thing to you. Unfortunately, I think that right now, in spite of the fact that the presentations are very well done, I think we have proof that the numbers on which the presentation is based need further validation. We need to be able to verify them. And there is certainly enough said tonight already to demonstrate the fact that there's plenty of reason to question them. And if the numbers are not correct, and the financial projections are based on those numbers, we are all facing peril. Even in the numbers presented tonight, from the slides up in front of us, we saw that the original projection, which was initially presented before the referendum, we were promised the numbers were good, 240 students. Now we have a number of 139, and we're being promised that those numbers are good. I spent 42 years in the insurance and reinsurance business. I know about data. I spent a lot of time playing with it and working with it. I know that if you constantly look out your rearview mirror and try to set your course for going forward by looking out your rearview mirror, you are in peril. We are using, to the best of my ability to see what's going on here, we are using history to determine our projection for future populations. And if we were to actually go and look at the demographics that are coming at us, and if we were to pay attention to the fact that Newtown and Bethel and Danbury and all the schools in our catchment area are all facing demographics that indicate declining populations, and they're trying to save their schools, and they're running through those kinds of campaigns, if we paid attention to that, I think we would have plenty of reason to take another look at the numbers that we're using here. And as a voter who voted based on the presentation that was given to us by these people sitting in front of us right now, I think the voters are entitled to another look, a new referendum, and we should see alternatives to this plan. Our students' needs should come first. If this plan is as flawed as it appears to be, the students are the ones who will be hurt. Our financial resources will be so constrained that not only will we not have the ability to keep the ag stem or the, whatever we want to call the science program running, but we may have to reduce what's available in the way of financial resources that would have otherwise been available to pay for and finance the education for the students that we have, because our financial resources will be aimed at debt service. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Diane McNulty in Bridgewater.
Thank you. I have some comments on the numbers. First, I'd like to thank the administration for preparing all this financial material. I know it represents a lot of hard work. But I have two main questions for the Board of Education. First, our state representative, O'Neill, told me that the state doesn't vet the numbers for the school projects. Instead, the state relies on local officials and they assume that the numbers have been reviewed adequately and are reliable. And I believe that job falls to the Board of Education. So my question to you is, what have you done to review the assumptions and calculations in the projections that were recently sent to the state and provided to us today? After many requests over the last couple of weeks, I finally did receive today, about midday, some backup from the superintendent's office on these numbers. I have not had a great amount of time to review these numbers, but I do have a couple of observations. First, there are some outright mistakes in the calculations, in the spreadsheets, addition mistakes, etc., which may or may not be critical to the decisions, but all of the numbers certainly need to be reviewed carefully to make sure they're correctly calculated. More importantly, most of the assumptions behind the numbers have no explanations, and none have been provided. For example, the expected ongoing revenue per student from the state is shown in these projections as about $2,900 per student. The projections that were provided to us before the referendum showed numbers of $3,200 per student. Now that's a reduction of 10% since a year ago. So I would like to know if you've reviewed how that formula about reimbursements is calculated from the state, for example, and if the number went down so much in 1 year, how much will it go down in the future? And therefore, how reliable are the revenue projections? Another example, all of the utilities, maintenance, insurance projections are based on the square foot cost in the past for existing buildings for those expenses. I would like to know, has anyone checked on the board to see if these past costs are even relevant for the new animal and greenhouse facilities? I would expect, for example, that insurance liability costs would be higher with this new these new facilities. I think there are a lot of other assumptions in the projections that definitely need to be analyzed carefully before we move forward. And I would like to ask the board what your plans are to make sure that these numbers are vetted properly so we have good numbers for decision making and spending. Now I have a second question. At what point are the numbers that were given so different than those presented previously that a new vote should be taken on options for the region? Over the life of the bond, the previous projections showed that AgSTEM revenues would cover the new program plus the cost of the science labs and make a profit of $700,000 to put towards other educational needs. We've been told today that even on the 139 student base case, there will be a cost for the AgSTEM project plus the new labs of almost $5 million. That's a huge swing from what we were told before. And if we only attract students equal to the number the catchment area is now committed to send, whether they do in the future or not, but if they send what they're now committed, the cost of the AgSTEM program plus the labs would be $11 or $12 million to the region. If the goal is to provide the best education for the students, are we willing to risk $11 million so 20 of our Region 12 students can have an education in agriculture? Or is it time to make a more thorough review of other options before moving forward? For example, we could give every student in the region $20,000 a year for their parents to pay for whatever private or other public school they choose and still save money. And that includes paying for those students in the region who currently attend private school. That may not be the right answer, but certainly we deserve a thorough review by the board of all our options before we commit to losing money on AgSTEM. Thank you.
Thank you. There's been a lot of questions answered. I'd like to, for the most part, try to answer them at the end because we'll be here really all night if we answer each person's questions, but Valerie Anderson can answer some of the questions that Ms. McNulty asked.
A voucher system does not exist in the state, so let's not even talk about that. And we're forgetting in our calculations that the total cost of the project, because we have right-sided it, which is what we should have been doing and have done, is down $6,556,000. So it is commensurate with the 139 and the operating costs. We have gone down $6,556,000, or in our actual debt that we will project. And then our square footage has gone down 17,000. So we are right-siding this project. In terms of the tuition charge to sending districts, that is, they have to pay, and they have to pay transportation. Some people might be confused about that. Is $6,823 per kid per year, plus a state reimbursement to all students of $2,861. Yes, indeed, $32,000 was the reported amount, but this year it's gone down to $2,861. So, yes, the state does make a change from time to time, but we are using these numbers. So basically, about $10,000 per student coming from any of the sending towns. Indeed, our students do not pay us $10,000. We get $2,861 for those students. In terms of expenses, we've been doing this for a long time. Our operating budget, I invite you all to come to Finance Committee hearings. We go through object code by object code. Nothing escapes our view. And those operating expenses are the basis of what has been projected to be operating expenses for the VOA program. All that information is out there. Come to our meetings.
All right, next is Eileen Leff, Bridgewater.
Yeah, I'm here as a founder with the Connecticut Community Foundation of the Western Connecticut Leadership Program, and we're committed to thriving communities and rewarding lives. I'm also a management consultant, formerly with McKinsey & Company. So my questions have to do more with the structure of how this project was addressed. And so perhaps all of these documents exist. That is a detailed needs analysis for this community and for the children in this community, and what the alternatives are that were examined and how this one was selected above others. And what the market analysis is, you said some of these jobs don't exist now, that they're going to be prepared for. Well, documentation says that in years to come, 30 to 60% of existing jobs will not exist, and there'll be a lot of technology and robots addressing all kinds of jobs. I'd also like to know what the cost alternatives were that were examined. Was this a blue sky projection, or did you review various levels of cost, considering alternative facilities that are nearby for the same purposes, and considering competitive organizations that are offering similar courses of study? And do you have a detailed sources and uses of funds that is guaranteed without a blue sky and that we can rely on? And I'd also like to know the hourly billing rates for the consultants that have been involved, and how this is the number one priority for your next steps, rather than setting aside as secondary science labs that will be involved in the accreditation of this organization.
Thank you. Just to answer your question on the hourly rates, Ken Viega from ONG charges $142 an hour, and Jennifer, I'm sorry on her last name, from Castle Booz is $150 per hour. And we have contracts with them in the office that are reviewed, anybody can review. All right, next is Dennis Adeletti, I'm sorry, from Roxbury.
Pretty contentious town politics and schools and things that we're trying to do to... Can't hear. All right, I'll pick it up. I think, no, I'll just leave it here. So, my question, if you can take it as a question, is we voted on this as a community, had a referendum, 70%, just shy of 70% voted yes. I do believe it's the Board of Ed's responsibility to bring this home at a reasonable number, but I think that work is being done. But I go back to the contentiousness that this whole project has created for all three towns. Got a big group of people here, right, that have not a lot to say that's really positive in the way that the folks, Dr. Constantino, Principal Gallo, they're doing everything they can to move education forward in Region 12. There's been some vacancies on the Board of Ed. I don't know if you people are aware of that. No one from this group, I think, volunteered their time. Besides crusade against something that 70% of the community, just shy of 70%, 69% of the community voted for. I don't care if my student can go into the room or not. That doesn't make a difference to me. Why should it?
All right, sir, do you want to address us, please?
Let him talk. That's not right.
It doesn't matter to me whether my student becomes part of the Ag STEM program or they don't become part of the Ag STEM program. The program enriches every student that comes to Region 12, whether they live here or whether they don't live here. It's been voted on. It's going to happen. We're going to have a new president come Friday. This was voted on. It's going to happen. It's going to happen.
Thank you. Thank you. Next is Hamilton Brower from the Milford. Hamilton Brower. All right, I don't see Mr. Brower. Next is Douglas DeLees from Bridgewater.
Good evening. I had the nagging feeling over the way this thing unfolded over the last couple of years that I had a feeling that I had a nagging feeling that I kind of knew something or felt something familiar about the whole process, and I came up with it the other night when I got up in the morning. I said, I know what I've been thinking of. Basically, what I was, now I'll read what I prepared, about 2 minutes. When the United States was expanding into the West in the 1800s, there was a phenomenon that nowadays will be considered totally politically incorrect, but in fact did exist. Men advertised for a wife with the intent of alleviating loneliness and finding a helpmate for the daunting work of raising a family and making a future on the frontier. On the basis of a picture and a few letters, couples would join their fortunes together, hoping for the best. Pretty romantic, right? Once the intended descended from the stagecoach, however, the law of unintended consequences often kicked in. The bride could have been significantly different in appearance than the soft focus tintype provided, or quite a bit longer in the tooth. The bridegroom might have looked like me, paunching, thinning hair, wearing spectacles, and limping a bit, rather than the bronco riding Adonis that she had dreamed of. On top of this disheartening scenario, the generous dowry that was to seal the deal couldn't be located in the luggage and was supposedly lost or stolen somewhere along the way. Truth in advertising had reared its ugly head and is at the heart of this argument. Why are a large number of families in our three towns now opposed to this mail-order bride proposition with a 20-year minimum duration and no chance of divorce? several points of contention that may have already been raised, but I think are preeminent. Bloated projections of students attending, almost twice as many as the board was dragged into admitting now. Head-scratching multi-million dollar features like an equestrian riding rink, no animal demonstration. It's amazing the speak that comes out. That may be a feature of private schools, but have no place in our high school level public school system, and of questionable value in a 21st century education. Millions of dollars in existing infrastructure needs completely ignored. 20 million, I thought I heard a little bit a while ago. State of Connecticut leaders would underwriting this project make sense when one of the unintended consequences of funding ASTE would be to raid surrounding districts and students that they will certainly need to maintain their own healthy levels. Region 12 will implement an excellent SDE program at our own expense.
Thank you. Next to Gary Lord from Roxbury. Gary Lord? Okay. Next is Keith Templeton from Washington.
I'll be very brief or try to. Every time the subject comes up as to whether we can have another referendum or not, it's pointed out that there's no requirement. We've met our legal duty here. And I think that's absolutely correct. However, I think that once it became apparent that the first vote had been taken on the basis of rubber numbers, it raises a moral obligation to revisit the whole topic. And I think that's what many of the speakers here tonight have focused on, and that would be my suggestion, that we need to be a lot more circumspect about rolling the dice with other people's money. Thanks very much.
Thank you. Next is Ken Schultz from Washington.
Well, you'll be happy to know I'll keep mine to 3 minutes.
Thank you.
Yeah. So we're here again, and it's certainly been an exhausting and frustrating and stressful 14 months since the Ag-STEM referendum. The debating, the arguing, the static, the confusion, the misdirection and misinformation that the naysayers, or the group they like to call themselves the residents of Region 12, have flooded and have saturated anyone who might listen, whether it's the superintendent of Danbury Schools or the State of Connecticut Office of Policy and Management. In fact, the only truthful aspect of their efforts to end the proposed Ag-STEM program at Shepaug is that it is selfish and self-serving. The group calling themselves the residents of Region 12, they're not invested in the education of our children. They have no alternative plan, nothing different to present. And not to sound cold, but many will not be around to have to deal with the aftermath 10, 15, 20 years down the road, when not only there won't be a Shepaug, but there won't be a Burnham, there won't be a Booth Free, or Washington Primary School. Or do I dare say the small businesses will suffer as well, such as Washington Market, Hickory Stick Bookshop, Roxbury Market and Deli, or the Bridgewater Village Store. Think about it, 100 years of business gone forever. See, the point that the naysayers are missing is it's not about money, and it's not about the enrollment numbers or what the old cost was or what the new cost is going to be. It's about every child currently enrolled in Washington Primary School, Booth Free, and Burnham, including the 3 and 4 year olds in Reach and the future elementary kids going into our schools in the region. It's about our children's future. Now, foremost, to thank the Board of Education for bringing clarity and truth to the situation. I can only imagine that this process has been as frustrating for you as it has been for the general public. But here is the good news. I want to close by telling everyone about another group, the parents of Region 12. We work hard, we are honest, we stand tall, and we never give up. It is the same lessons we teach our children every day and put them down to bed each night. We are passionate. Yes, we might not make every Board of Education meeting or have the time to write letters every week, but we will. It's because we have put the trust in the Board of Education members to represent us so we can be at home having dinner as a family, having those family time and discussions, helping with homework, and putting our children down to rest for the night. We are the same group that was part of passing the Ag STEM referendum by a 70% vote. We are the group that is invested in our children's, our friends' children, and our neighbors' children. It does take a village to raise and educate our children. That's how a community is created. Lastly, it is our young families that not only will have a stake, but will dictate the direction of our children's education and the community in which they live in. That is the way to ensure a sustainable future for Region 12 schools for generations to come, and that's the way it has to be. Thank you.
Roxbury.
Hi, I'm here to continue to urge the board to proceed with this project. I know that over the past year and a half since this project initially passed, you've heard a lot of negative feedback, and it might seem that the community does not want this project to happen. But I know that this group over here is very small, and trust me, the majority in all three towns will continue to want this project to proceed. I have no doubt the numbers that you've presented that will meet those expectations with the enrollment, knowing a lot of the families, not only in Shepaug, but the surrounding towns, New Milford and Brookfield, et cetera, they are interested in this. They want this to happen. I have no doubt that we'll meet enrollment. In regards to what looks like, on average, about the 200,000 deficit that we might face with the program, over the years that I've really been involved in what the Board of Education has done, they've always been really financially aware and have always, you know, tried to make the budget neutral or tried to have the least amount of impact to the taxpayers. I have no doubt in those years where we are expected to maybe have a deficit that they will keep that in consideration. For those who are only concerned that this program isn't going to meet the needs of all the students here and that there's other options, I would love to hear those other options because I've been here for over 10 years and all I've heard is that's not good enough, figure something else out to the board. That's not good enough, figure something else out. And with no solution in hand. So when this was presented, for me, I was really excited about it because I can see for the kids in this region who are excited about Ag STEM, my children being some of those kids, not only does it, is it enticing to those students who may not be great students, but agriculture is very motivating for them. But also in terms of the technology, for the kids who maybe are academically higher achieving, it meets their needs as well. And in terms of meeting the needs of the kids who aren't in the Ag STEM program, the problem that we have right now is our decreasing numbers. And if you're not aware of that, then I don't know where you've been, but we have grades coming up with 40 kids. And we are not going to have a viable high school with 40 kids in a grade. So we need to have kids in this school to make this whole region work. And I'd love to hear of a program that you have that's gonna bring 100 kids into this region, but I haven't heard it. So, and what, by bringing those kids in, even if our kids are not participating in that program, what it does is it allows us to have teams, sports teams. It allows us to have dramatics. It allows us to have music. It allows our other classes, English, electives, it allows those classes to be filled, and it allows more options in those classes. So every single student will benefit from this program. And I think the parents are for this because they know that. They know that we need kids at this point in this region. So I urge you to proceed with this project in order to save the region, because there is no other option. Thank you.
Nathan Stennis from Roxbury. Stennis, I'm sorry.
My name is Nathan Steinish, and I am in fourth grade at Booth Reed School. I am excited about having the Ag STEM school at Shepaug because I'm really good at math and I like science. I also love sports, and I want there to be enough kids at Shepaug so that I can be on a team and have fun playing in games. I know there are grown-ups who are worried that if we don't have Ag STEM, there may not be enough players for some sport teams or for other fun groups. I hope you think of kids like me when you make your vote for Ag STEM. I think my friends and I deserve to have a school that gives us a lot of choices for school and fun activities. Ag STEM will.
What's up? Next is Savannah Shea, I believe, of Roxbury.
Samantha Steinis, on his
mind. Oh, I'm sorry. Yep,
sorry, my sloppy handwriting.
Yes.
I know many members of the board have spent countless hours towards the betterment of the education in Region 12, and I want to thank you for all of your hard work and your dedication, and please know that it is appreciated by so many people. I recently found a quote by a British statistician, Klaus Moser. Education costs money, but then so does ignorance. We cannot ignore the fact that our enrollment is declining and we need to bring students and families into this region. The passing of the Ag STEM vote has already been done, and I believe that this passing has brought new families to this region and will continue to do so. If we do not have the Ag STEM program, our numbers, according to Prado's report, are bleak. In the year 2020, we will have about 220 students in the high school, not counting any Sherman students. In the year 2026, we will have 146 students at the high school, not counting any Sherman students. What kinds of choices will we be able to offer our students then? I love my town, I love the school system, but I would have a difficult time staying here if this will be the future for my children. Most certainly, we will have an extremely difficult time attracting more families to this region. You've heard the scenario before. Without young families, we will not have a capable volunteers for ambulance and fire department. That will lead to a paid ambulance and paid fire department, which will in turn lead to higher taxes. We are fortunate to live in a community where we have some of the lowest mill rates in the state. We need to focus on education, on the youngest members of our community, the most precious members of our community. That comes at a cost. The majority of voters already approved a larger cost for this project. Many people are comfortable with that cost and fully support it because they know that it is what is best for our children and for our community. And there aren't any other alternatives. I've been on long-range planning committees for years, and this is it. So do we pay now for education or do nothing and pay later? I hope the board will honor the majority of the voters who cast their ballots in favor of Ag STEM, and by doing so, do what is best for the children and for our community.
All right, next is, I'm sorry, sir, you're not next.
I'm the next guy.
No, you're not.
Well,
next is Sue Nicholas.
Come on up, come on up, Jim, come on up.
Sit down.
It's not your turn.
My turn?
No, it's not your turn.
It's my turn. Oh, gee whiz. It's not my turn. All right.
Sue Nicholas of Washington.
Good evening. My name is Sue Nicholas. And first of all, I'd like to thank the board for serving the communities of Region 12 and also supporting the education of our students. This has been a long road, and I appreciate every single minute that you've given. I'd also like to thank the administration for the presentation tonight and multiple presentations over the last few, more than a few months. Once again, I come before you to ask you to move forward with the Ag STEM project. I believe that this project is a lifeline for this district. I voted for the referendum, and I really would like to continue with this process. Seeing parents here tonight, hearing young babies, knowing that parents are out this evening with their children because they support this, brought forth something totally different than what I wanted to say. And it was a quote. And this quote is that the question is not whether we can invest in every child, it's whether we can afford not to. And that's Marion Wright Edelman. So I believe that investing in children is not a luxury, it is a necessity. Please go forward with the Ag STEM program. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Holly Floor from Rochburn. Holly Floor from Rochburn.
You surprised me, Jim. I thought I was number 38 or 48 or something. Thank you. Just a couple of quick things. One is that, in fact, 31.5% of the actual available voters passed this referendum. It wasn't 70% of everyone who was qualified to do so. And in spite of some of the callous comments about the age of various people in the audience, I would add that there are alternatives. I've asked the board a number of times in previous meetings what some of those alternatives that they explored were, and I've never gotten an answer. And the group of people who are opposed to this program have in fact produced some alternatives. And perhaps at a near future date, we can have 45 minutes to do a presentation on some of those alternatives. It isn't that we don't care about the children, those of us whose children are grown, and it isn't that we don't care about the time. We just think that there are better alternatives than a program that's going to lock us in for 20 some odd years. We would really like the opportunity to discuss alternatives so that everyone can see that there may be something that they like better than AgriSTEM, or that the group that's opposed to it may say, gee, maybe AgriSTEM is the best solution. So I would ask the board, I would ask the administration, and I'd ask everyone in town, let's look at what is available. We may come back to this conclusion that AgSTEM is the best thing, but we've never been presented with an alternative other than closing the school, and there are, in fact, other alternatives. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Ed Wainwright, Bridgewater.
Oh, is it my turn?
Yes, it is.
I'd like to make a point. I've been a resident 45 years here in Bridgewater, and my wife and I have served on the Board of Education for 10 years collectively, and I want to offer an alternative. It's called STEM only option and renovate the science labs. The science lab renovation project, the debt is projected at $2.6 million over 20 years. That $2.6 million over 20 years has an average debt service of $131,000 a year. And I would propose that the school hire three, can you hear me?
Yep.
You're able to hear me. Hire three high school STEM teachers at $100,000 each. And if you total that budget, $133,000 debt service and $300,000, it comes to $433,000. That's less than the current existing debt pay on an annual basis. and that debt is retired in June of 2019. It's a straightforward thing. It has no budget impact. It will not impact your budget. It's straightforward. It's cost-effective. It does a lot for all of our students, not for all the guys outside the region, but does a lot for all of our students. And you say that it's required for, or we'll lose our accreditation. That alternative should be investigated. I can't believe that you don't have it investigated. In fact, you could use the $1 million Diebold gift to implement that, and you could probably get rid of the prevailing rate wage requirement and reduce the cost of doing that. And there's no need for catchment districts. This is very complicated. It's not necessary. I can't believe, and the superintendent, I have one other point I wanted to make. The superintendent takes responsibility. Have you ever heard of the word fraud? Fraud.
That's right, fraud.
What are you doing?
I'm handing out material so that
they
can read.
All right, Dr.
Costanio. I do want to just clarify. I hope Joan is still here. I don't know if she is, but I will call her tomorrow if she is not. At last Monday's board meeting, I presented to the board that we owed money to Castle Blues and ONG. We have not paid a dime of that money. We've paid them nothing since June of 2016, maybe beginning of July. The reason we owe that money is because we had to work with Castle Blues and ONG to get on the priority list. We had many meetings with the building committee. The Board of Education was aware of every step that we took. I have many correspondence from the building committee. Board members have ONG do this, have Castle Blues do that. So that's the first piece. The second piece that came up, yes, we were told at the end of June or May that by Melody Curry, who's the commissioner at DAS, that we needed to be put in a year delay, and we needed to work with DAS. Well, no one was around in the summer. And then when DAS started to get moving, we had many meetings with them. And they were meetings to right-size the project, which happens in every project that happens in the state. You start with a population, they want you to go lower. They have a certain amount of square footage, they want you to decrease it. They want the cost to go down, all of these things back and forth. We actually had a couple of meetings at DAS where we had to have Castle Blues and ONG there because our architects have to work with their architects. These people do not work for free, okay? We have a contract with them. There is, I have no problem sitting here and listening to the community's concerns. Happy to answer any questions. I do have a problem when people are suggesting that there's fraud or anything else. The reason I took responsibility is because I'm the superintendent and anything that happens in the district is my responsibility. I explained to the Board of Education, it was my number one goal to be on that priority list. And in order to get on that priority list, we needed to work with DAS and we needed to right-size this project. And the only way to do that was with the architects and with the construction manager. We have not paid a penny of that money. The Board of Education decided to pay the money because we owed the money. We still haven't paid the money because the building committee, under the guidance of Greg Caba, the chair, is going to look at all of the bills and make sure that they are appropriate. So I please do not leave here thinking that anything was done inappropriately, because it was not. And I do take offense to that. Just
I hope that when you're out of order, you're done. Please sit down.
Next, yes, you are done. You've had your time. Next is Peter Mariano of Roxbury.
I'll be quick. It's late. My wife is already trying to put our three to bed. I thank the Board of Ed for your time. Any project proposal can be picked apart, given the time to pick apart the proposal or the project. Thinking that the best years are behind us or have already gone by is a grim outlook for the future. The towns of Region 12 voted yes. I wonder with the opponents, if the vote was tallied yes again, still find reason to disbelieve the project and be opposed to it. And finally, the STEM project is serving areas of growth, the only areas of growth that are being shown in the job market in Connecticut and across the country, which is the medical fields, the science fields, food science industries. So it is that someone said that jobs are not yet created, kind of true, but the fact that the jobs are happening, the jobs that are being created are in exactly what this school will be preparing students for. So thank you.
Jay Stewart, Washington. Jay?
My name is Sheila Anson, and I am speaking on behalf of Jay Stewart, who had to leave to go work on field hockey drills for next fall. Her message, we are the class of 1974. Her message is directed to the board. I appreciate your time and energy that you give freely and without thanks to those of us in Region 12. I hope there are no board members conflicted, wondering if the project is too big, too little, or too costly. The voters already made that decision. They entrusted you to represent their vote. It's time to move ahead. God bless the schools of Region 12, and God bless America. Thank you.
Washington. Good evening. When I was on the Board of Ed, it wasn't as exciting as this. It's almost better than a gong show. Can you hear me? Can you hear me now? I can hear me. My name's Randy Carrera. Before I came up, I realized I've had kids in the system since 1987. Kids and stepkids, seven total. I served on this Board of Ed. I have some appreciation for the district. I moved out up here from down south and lived in Danbury. I moved here specifically because I wanted to have my kids in a good school system. I think that I agree with a lot of the people who spoke here about the numbers. I don't think it's a viable remedy to the issue of degrading the student population. However, if you look at it, if it's successful, what's gonna happen? And this is where you get into unintended consequences. You're gonna have a student body of, as they project, 120, 130, 140, 200, whatever numbers they come up with this week. It's not going to be Shepaug. It's going to be driven by state regulations, ag STEM regulations, what courses, what segregation. This board is going to have less choice than it did before. And you're going to have boards of ed from five or six other towns making determinations that are going to determine the future of everybody's kids here. Or grandkids, and the old folks, if we don't die, as one person suggested, that's one way to get rid of a voter. Unintended consequences, you're gonna change the whole complexion of this, and I frankly think if this thing fails, your elementary schools will be on the block. And all those folks, and believe me, my first public meeting I ever went to, town hall, that's when I was in Bridgewater, town meeting, was about the consolidation of the schools, and I think that was in the late 80s. So that keeps rearing its head. and it'll rear its head again, folks. So you've got, I think the number that I heard was almost 200 students in district right now that are going to other schools. That's a nice target to grab. Where are they going? Are they going to other public schools out of district? Are they going to private schools? Can you become the immaculate high school of the area that people will make sure you send to? Can you become the A1, the D1? Maybe that's a direction to start thinking of. Anyway, thanks a lot, folks.
Thank you. Our attorney, Gary Brochu, this issue of if this AgSTEM program were to pass and we took students in from other towns, that the composition of the Board of Ed would change. Mr. Brochu, are you prepared to address that? Sure. Could you come up here?
Briefly, should Region 12 become a VOAG district, it remains Region 12, represented by the current three communities with the current composition of the board. That doesn't change at all. That's true of every VOAG program in the state of Connecticut.
Somebody just asked me how far along we are. We are on number 27 of 48. Next is Mr. Jim Conway of Roxbury.
Thank you. I want to begin by saying I totally 100% support AgSTEM. And secondly, I would like to say that I thank the Board of Education for all the work they've done. I trust their numbers, I trust their predictions, and I think with what they're presenting, I urge you to go forward with. The alternative, I feel I'm concerned if we do nothing at this time that our school will be in jeopardy. Kind of feel that Hartford is testing us, testing Region 12, to see how serious we are to keep our very small, fragile school alive. And I think this test is doable, and I urge you to go forward and get ready and see what Hartford thinks. Thank you.
Thank you. This is Emily Holland of New Milford.
Hello, I'm here on behalf of my grandfather, Bill Holland. My grandfather sees the answer to many issues as improving education in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. He has emphasized to me that a successful future includes a workforce educated in math and science, ready to apply their skills in the workplace. Having seen the vast number of passionate people involved on both sides of this AgSTEM issue, I hope that collaboration between teachers, parents, administrators, community members, businesses, and maybe most importantly, the future students will give the future of a responsibly transformed Shepaug school tremendous potential. Family, school, community partnerships, and agreements are a shared responsibility, so let us not lose sight of our shared effort to create a better educational future for new generations.
Next is Edwin Matthews of Washington.
My name is Edwin Matthews. I've lived in Washington for 25 years. My wife and I have approved and voted for the AgSTEM program based on the disclosures that were made to us at the previous meeting and what we understood the program to be. Since I just want you to know that I've been heavily involved in education all my life, nothing is more important, and environmental education in Connecticut on the secondary school level, and was even recognized last year as the person in Connecticut who made the most contribution to environmental education. Since this was considered before by the voters, serious questions have been raised about the program, about the numbers, about the rationale for it, And I believe that they have not been answered this evening, and they have not been answered for the public. There is a lack of confidence, I believe, in the explanations that have been given for this program. I do not believe that the Board of Education dares proceed with substantial opposition in this community, in the three communities involved, to this program. You need to answer these questions in a detailed fashion and have the overwhelming majority of the people in this town support the program. Otherwise, it will fail. Thank you.
Thank you. Next is Paul Elwell of Roxbury.
Hello, I'm Paul Elwell, a practicing veterinarian in Roxbury. And I've been involved with the ag program in this area for probably 50 years or better. I'm 75 years old and I plan on seeing the end of this program. Even be this as it may. I am neither totally in favor of it nor opposed to it. I think it's time we did some thinking about the program. When we think about agriculture in the area, most of us get this bucolic picture of the sheep in the meadow and the cows in the corn, the chickens running around the yard, and the pigs down in the pen, and the goats or the chickens running around the yard and all that kind of stuff. Well, that's nice. And that's very good. But back in the 70s, when I was practicing with Dr. Ferris Gora in Marbledale, we counted and verified 80 serviceable dairy clients in the area. We also had several purebred horse projects, Arabs and quarter horses, internationally known. Curtis Reed was involved in a project involving sheep for Sunny Valley. But that's not the way it is now. Now our agriculture has become grass-fed beef, grains, fruits, and vegetables. Our herds have left, they've moved to Utah. The sheep have left, they went to Rhode Island. Our dairy cows have left, they went to New York State. So we need to rethink what agriculture is in here. We have a lot of craft farms which produce a small quantity of a specified product for direct sale to the communities. Agriculture is not what it was before. And tonight, by and large, more or less, we've been given a lot of specific generalities. And I think it's time that we really got down to what are we going to do with this program? What are we going to teach these kids? And anybody under 35, as far as I'm concerned, is a kid. You know, what are we gonna teach here? Are we gonna present something that is gonna keep the students in this area? Are they gonna become members of the Board of Education? Are they gonna become firemen, firewomen? Are they gonna respond to ambulance calls? I don't know. Will they have to go to Rhode Island or New York or Utah or Aiken, South Carolina to put their jobs into effect? How about further education? Will this program actually allow them to go on to further other education opportunities? I think there are other alternatives, maybe within this same program. If you're trying to hire a carpenter lately, or a plumber, or an electrician? Is there any wiggle room in this program where we could teach some of the general trades. And what's it going to cost to keep this animal fed if we create it? Are there teachers available that can teach the subjects? Do we actually have a curriculum? Do we know what we're going to teach? How can we stand here and talk about buildings and parking lots and science labs if we don't know what we're going to teach? Is there going to be a meat lab? We've got a lot of grass-fed beef. Are we going to teach these kids how to cut meat? You know, what are we going to teach them? How many people in the area make their living in a horse arena now? My thought is, let's think a little bit about what we're actually going to present with this program. And it sounds very nice, and it sounds wonderful, and it's going to save our schools. But let's see a curriculum. What are we really going to teach with this? I think we need to rethink a little bit on this build it and they will come. You know, what are they going to come to? I have yet to see that. Nice words, well pronounced up there, but what are we really going to teach?
Thank you. I will say that there is a curriculum. We don't have it with us tonight. It's available at the central office. If anybody wants it, we will send it to them. Next is Mr. Will Mira from Washington.
How's everyone doing? Thanks for sticking around. My name is Will Mira. I'm 22 years old. I'm a farmer in Washington, and I've been farming here since I was 16 years old. I'm one of the farm managers at Waldingfield Farm over on East Street. You might know us. So I just wanted to illuminate some statistics that I believe will demonstrate why programs like this are necessary as we start to think about the jobs that are going to exist, the face of agriculture in our region is Mr. Elwell, is that correct? Dr. Elwell, sorry. As Dr. Elwell brought up just now. And these are from the National Young Farmers Coalition, a membership organization that I'm an active part of with a branch in Connecticut called the New Connecticut Farmers Alliance. So as we look forward in our agricultural sphere, we see that for every farmer 35 and younger, there are six over the age of 65. The average age of farmers in this country is 57. A quarter of all farmers, about 500,000 in the whole country, will retire in the next 20 years. On top of that, in the state of New York, the region is very similar. 92% of farmers over the age of 65 have no younger land tenants who are able to pick up agricultural production or even the maintenance of that land when they pass away or retire or whatever it may be. Let's see. Excuse me, can't see in this light. In New England states, there are three that rank the first, second, and third in direct-to-consumer sales from farms. Connecticut, unfortunately, is not one of those states, but our neighbors to the north in Massachusetts sell 10% of all food consumed in the state direct-to-consumer from farmers. The national average is about 2%, to give you some context. Let's see. The food and farming revolution is occurring in Connecticut, whether it looks like it or not. There are a growing number of breweries and butcher shops and other organizations that are supporting farmers that grow hops, that grow wheat, that raise animals, things like this that will strengthen and revitalize our community. As small farms once again grow, we're going to need ag engineers to make more equipment appropriate to the scale of the farms that exist in this region. We're going to need slaughterhouses to process the animals that are raised for meat consumption. As an example, my friend Tom Trulove in Morris drives his animals to North Adams, Massachusetts, to Adams Slaughterhouse in Athol, Massachusetts, about 2.5 hours away. And they're an excellent slaughterhouse, but they're currently facing in excess of what they can handle. They had a nasty E. coli, whether they're producers, processors, marketers, whatever it may be. I received a degree in agriculture from the University of Massachusetts, the Stockbridge School of Agriculture. Unfortunately, the programs in Connecticut weren't quite cut out for the ag production that I'm hoping to do to strengthen this kind of community. But the job that I have right out of graduation helps me pay those outrageously high student loans that I need to take out to go out of state. So I would encourage you to think about the types of students that are going to be coming through here, the way that they might be able to change the face of this region, make us look a little bit more like Massachusetts, where 10% of the food consumed is grown right here. Those dollars recirculate in this economy. They support the Washington supply. They support the market. They support all of the restaurants in the area that we all like to frequent. So, you know, while it may cost a little bit more to pay these taxes for the deficits that you all seem to be so afraid of, I would encourage you to think of the other ways in which it would strengthen the community. Thank you.
Stay out this late anymore, but I'm Jay Hubblebank from Washington. I'm currently a selectman, and I served on the Region 12 Board of Ed for a number of years. And I'm invested in my town and the school district, and I have heard people talk about enrollment issues at this school, and I think that's really the crux to me of not only our school but our towns. If we don't offer quality education to our students, we can't attract the families into our towns. Now, I know people talk about having other students come from other places, but that's what makes the school district a quality school district. If we can attract not only kids from outside, but get families to move into these towns. We all know, as somebody talked about, lack of volunteer firemen, ambulance folks, and the like. We really need to look at how our schools can help with that issue in our towns. And I won't go over, people have talked quite a bit about the sports teams and the others, and I think those things are essential for our schools to be quality. Also, while I was working, I worked for 5 years as the business manager at Region 14. One of the interesting things I saw there all the time was how the kids that came from outside the district helped to improve the quality of the school. Those kids tended to be the kids who were the valedictorian. Those kids were high quality kids who interacted daily with the other kids from Bethlehem and Woodbury who didn't necessarily take any of the ag programs. We had families that moved into Woodbury and Bethlehem because their kids couldn't get in the program if they lived in Watertown or somewhere else. They moved to Woodbury or Bethlehem so that their kid could get into the ag program. It made a big difference in those two towns in attracting people, and I think that's what one of the things that we need to do in order to get our schools, to bring our communities to continue to have high quality communities. So I support your effort to continue to move this program forward. I think you've done a great job of putting together the information. We've studied it, as far as I'm concerned, long enough, and it's time to move forward.
Next is Dave Balaban, Roxburn. Dave Balaban? I'm sorry. No? All right, next is Monique Gill Rogers of Washington.
He's also not here.
All right. Next is Christy Hardy of Roxbury.
Thank you for all of the hard work you guys have done. It goes without saying that many of us are very, very appreciative. My name is Christy Hardy, and I stand before you tonight to put my family support back behind the Shepaug Extend program. There are a lot of numbers and statistics that keep getting thrown at you, but there's really just the one that I want you to remember, and that is that vote, our referendum that passed. And I know some people have said that, you know, it, only a certain amount of people had actually voted. If they felt passionate, they should have come out to vote. Those of us who were passionate about it, even the other voting. So I just wanted to say that. Our family moved to Roxbury for a reason, and the reason was not a dollar sign. It wasn't to be in a prestigious community. It was about the people that we met within this community. We saw people who were passionate about education for our children and the other children of the community, and we also saw community support. I moved here so my children could understand what community can do and what it actually means. How a small community can support you in time of need, in time of heartache, which some of us have seen, and in times of joy. This community is special. I'm proud to live here. I'm proud to know that the people of our community believe in supporting all of our citizens, from the smallest little baby in the back to the most elderly senior that's here tonight. Can we continue the support of this AgSTEM program to make sure that we keep our community supporting one another and supporting generations to come?
Thank you. This is George Stripe, Washington.
George Stripe?
No? All right, we're on the last page. Approximately 12 names on the list. Next is Mr. Russ Dorenzo of Roxbury.
Good evening. Glad to see everybody here. I'm a selectman in Roxbury, and I'm proud to serve with Jim Conway and Barbara Henry. Barbara is off skiing, and we went to a selectman meeting a couple weeks ago, and Barbara Henry got right up there and asked the governor straight to straight, are you in support of this program? And he said he supports AgSTEM. We asked our legislators, are you in support of this program? We know the state has money problems. They said you need to get shovel ready. That's what we need to do. And let's be straight here. We could go spend $700,000 or $1 million getting shovel ready, and they could screw it up, because they've screwed a lot up. I know that's a fact. But I'm willing to invest, and in order to get this community going again, and save this great school, if you don't come here every day and stand in that mall and see what goes on, if you don't deal with the teachers like I have, we have the best teachers around. We're better than the private schools. I don't know why the rich people send their kids to the private schools when they have to talk right here. We need to move it forward. We don't get the shovel ready. If you don't make that vote Monday night, the state's gonna pass you by. Barbara Henry called Ben Barnes, laid it on the line with him. She was very upset that he did not talk to any of the leadership of any of the three towns before that letter out came out. How dare he send a letter out like that saying, you don't have the support, when 1,697 people voted in favor of it. We do have the support. The parents are here. My three kids are home right now. I hope they're eating their Subway subs, I don't know. But the parents aren't here because we're busy. We depend on our Board of Education to be our leaders. I'm a leader in Roxbury. I want to make sure our town thrives. Agriculture is the way to go. We need to invest, we need to take the risk, and we need to move it forward Monday night. Enough of this.
Jessica Granger of Roxbury.
Okay, can everyone hear me okay? I have the opposite problem of Samantha Stinus. Well, everyone, I just invested about 6 times what the annual deficit might be to become a resident of Roxbury. And I probably could have also paid the Castle Booze and the other bill a few times and the remodeling that I've been trying to do on my fixer-upper. So we're now residents, me and my daughter Samantha and my husband Adam. And we came from Danbury. And we came and we moved in because of the possibility of this program and the possibility of the future. I read at some point
along the way that the Region 12 Board of Ed got a Connecticut AA bond rating with the Fitch ratings. That's pretty impressive to me. It sounds like they manage responsibly and do some pretty damn good work. I've been an international business consultant for over 5 years, over 15 years before I had my daughter. I worked for the Department of Defense, the FDIC, nuclear energy, and numerous other industries all over the world. And this is how big projects run. Numbers are created, they're tweaked, they're adjusted. That's a normal course of business. And I've done it for many industries, and I've seen it all over. That's how things run. The U.S. Department of Commerce has reported STEM workers drive our nation's innovations and competitiveness over the past 10 years. Growth in STEM jobs was 3 times as fast as growth in non-STEM jobs. According to the U.S. Department of Agriculture, 58,000 high-skill agriculture-related jobs are expected to open up between 2015 and 2020. Which are jobs in food, renewable natural resources, environmental industries, but they have fewer than 30,000 graduates in these related fields that are expected to enter the workforce. That sounds like a pretty good industry to get into and to study in school. These jobs will only become more important as the world needs to develop solutions to feed more than 9 billion people by 2050. There's a viable need for ag STEM education in this wider community that has not been met for years by Region 14. I'm also a Nanawa graduate. I travel there 45 minutes each way in my beat-up car for high school from Danbury. And that's a basic need that's not being met, and that's really a core requirement for any new successful business plan. As it's been said, just under 70% voted yes. It's been voted. It's done. The United States voted a new president, like it or not. We have a new president. It was voted for. You might not like the president. You might not like the system. But that's a system that's in place. Everyone's got to get behind the decision and move forward and stop this analysis paralysis and wasting more money and more time. Basically coming to the same conclusion that we need to move forward to make this region stronger in the community.
Thank you. This is Spencer Hardy of Washington.
Hi, my name is Spencer Hardy. I've lived here for 25 years. And I want to correct the impression that we're against this program. I was for this program from the beginning, and I see that the numbers have all changed. And I just call into question how it's going to be profitable. We are paying all this money to bring students in, hopefully from other towns, and if it doesn't work, then we're going to be stuck with quite a bill. How much money has been spent so far on all the money for this AgSTEM program?
Yeah, we have that number.
And I think if more could be done to keep our students that are local in our school, we'd be doing a lot better. I think the science, technology, engineering, and math are all kind of, you know, what you need to get into college, and that's what we should be pushing for. Thank you.
Thank you. Just to answer your question, on the bottom line, what's been spent is $318.95. The pending that the board approved the other night, subject to the building committee's review, was $138. For a total of $456. That's total since before the referendum to date. Pre-construction, etc.
Is that available?
Legal. It's right there.
That's the only place it's available?
No.
Go ahead.
We included some slides in case questions came up. Tomorrow we will update the website. It was really just background information for us, but we will certainly share that with you tomorrow. It's all public information. It'll be on the website in the morning.
All right, thank you. Next is Mr. Jim McDonough in Washington.
The funny thing is, when I showed up, I thought I was number four on the list.
You were number four on page three.
Right. So my name is Jim McDonough, and I just have to say I don't have cable, so this has been pretty entertaining here on both sides. And obviously, like everybody else, I absolutely honor and respect everything that you've done as a board here. And I would say as well, to the erstwhile opposition, I am in support of Ag STEM. To the erstwhile opposition, I appreciate and respect, the robust debate that's going on. I think that's part of what makes this town so special, the fact that we can have, this kind of turnout. Full disclosure, I am a teacher here at Shepaug, and I'm also one of those volunteers that have been spoken about on the Washington Ambulance crew, but don't worry if you have that impending medical emergency at 2:30 in the morning, I'll treat you right, okay? So, I guess the audience is sparse here because people have gone home, to put their kids to bed, et cetera, et cetera. Lions Club meeting was tonight, all sorts of civic things going on. But the one thing that I saw as I was reaching out to people is a lot of people didn't feel like they needed to voice their opinion or come to show up because they thought it was a done deal. We talked about the vote, and they said, look, we voted way back when, and really, there's a delay, but I thought that was going forward. And so I had to explain to them the whole process. And I think I've been a little bit more educated than most people because I've been showing up to some board meetings. And as I see the process, it was up there on the slide, but it was voted on. 70% of the voters said that they wanted an Ag STEM program. Then I went to a couple meetings, and at one, somebody brought up the numbers, and they said, the numbers don't work, the numbers don't work, the numbers don't work. So I was pleased when the board went, and members of the board went back to the state and reworked the numbers and downsized the whole project. And I was thinking, in this day and age, to have sort of a bipartisan project come out, from two opposing sides, it seemed perfect. And I figured, okay, now what's the opposition? If the numbers worked out with the state are sort of a compromise, what's the deal? And now when we get to it and you tell me that it's even less, than the bond is less than what the voters voted for, to me it's almost a no-brainer. It's basically, if you went to the people and said, look, we're gonna do a smaller project, it'll come in $4 million less than what you actually approved, I think they would be in agreement. But what I would say, and I'm going to end my comments the way that I've ended most of my comments at board meetings, is that at some point, as a board, you got to make the decision. It's been going on way too long. And my hope, obviously, as a supporter, is that you remember those 1,600 people who came out and voted yes, and then put it in your lap, and not let them get drowned out by 16 or 20 people who are tenacious and very vocal. And again, I know Monday night is gonna come very quickly, and I know when you get to those quiet places where you make those decisions, I hope you consider those 1,600 people. Thanks.
Thank you. Just to note that the presentation tonight was that the cost of the project was reduced by approximately $6 million, not $4 million. And I'm sure that the places on Monday will not be quiet. Next is Jesse Barr from Washington. Jesse Barr? No, Jesse. Okay. Next is Michael Kirsten from Washington.
Jim, if I reach 3 minutes, feel free to interrupt and cut me off. There's been a lot been said tonight, and I don't really want to repeat it. I spoke about 3 months ago at the Board of Ed meeting, and I apologize if some of this is repetitive. I'm the youngest of five who grew up in this school system. I have two daughters who are just starting out, and three nephews and nieces that are coming also through the school system. So I approach it a little bit differently with a face with this whole project. And be quite honest with you, having the experience of coming here, the youngest of five, attending many events in this school, having to know some of the quality people and parents and teachers and fortunate to live in Roxbury, Washington, Bridgewater. And I can assure you, I have no problem saying my parents are blue collar through and through. We didn't have the money that a lot of people did, but we certainly had as good of a childhood as I could ever imagine. I don't get caught up in the dollars and cents, and I one thing I do admire the folks that oppose this, I admire your passion, and I respect that. But I look at the faces. And you know, I could go on and on why I think it's a good program and why my wife and I moved back here. We were living in Litchfield's apartment and so forth because of the experiences I have. I don't know if everybody has that experience. And there's a lot of people that could speak passionately to their experience going through the school system. And it goes on and on and on for the reasons why. I invite you, a few of you, I would suggest or maybe offer. I made this comment, and I don't mean to offend people. I made it 3 months ago. On a Saturday morning, I see more non-Connecticut plates go up and down my house. I'm a mile outside of Baldwin Hill. And the road across from me, there's probably $6-8 million easily homes, maybe plus. There's been a few comments about maybe what we could do. I did a postgraduate at the Gunnery, and the only reason was to play football. To be quite honest, I knew another year academics was good, but it was a year to play football. I've officiated at the prep schools, just came from a prep school before this. I've been in a lot of school systems. My wife's a teacher, my brother's a teacher. I'm by no means am an expert, but Shepaug was the immaculate, if not better, back in the day, and I still believe it is one of the best schools around. You know, people talk about when the real estate market keeps going up like it has in this time, people are going to go. People are going to prep schools forever. That's not going to change. You're not going to keep those people. I would just finish on this. Go down to a REACH program. Go down to a kindergarten program. Go in there for an hour. Read to the 3.5-4-year-olds. Put a face. Okay. There's a little, trophy case. It's not a trophy case. There's a case out there with Stephen Reich, who's a former graduate of the school. You can Google his name, look him up. There's been the quality of people that come through here, and it's not just it's teachers, it's the community. It's a lot of reasons why people like myself want this program and hopefully this school to continue. And you know, I could go on and on, but I completely support it. I thank you for all your efforts, and thank you.
Thank you. Six names to go, but Ms. Galva wanted to address the audience on an issue just briefly.
I stand by everything I said this evening. However, the one thing that I want to make sure and clarify is the issue of the use of facilities. While it's true that an ag program, I can't put an AP biology class in an ag lab. I can't put a general math class in an ag lab. That is true. Those facilities are to be used exclusively because of the state grants. However, any general ed student, when there's room in an ag class, can join that class. And they do. And they will. And secondly, every student will be affected by this program every year through cross-curricular opportunities. And if any of you want to talk to me about that, talk with more specificity, I'm happy to do it. I'm proud of what we're trying to do, and I want to make sure that we don't leave here tonight thinking that any students are going to be left behind. Every student is my student, and it will remain that way. Shepaug is a special class.
Next, Michael Jackson. I know he was here. He left. All right. Next. Next is Scott Workoven, Washington.
I'm Scott Workoven from Washington. I'm a Washington resident, teacher at Shepaug, but most importantly, a parent of three children beginning in Washington Primary School. I'd just like to reiterate the support of our family again for this program. It's pretty clear that Shepaug is community's a special place. It was special when we were growing up here. I grew up with Mike Kirsten, the people who looked out for us as we were kids, whether it was in this school or in the community, and now it's our turn to look out for the kids coming through. And the best way we can do that is to provide them the best education here in our community. And for years, the parents of this district have trusted this Board of Education to make the best decisions for our children. And you always have. And we trust that you'll continue to do so. Thank you. Thank you.
This is Tim Laughlin of Washington.
Good evening, everybody. My name is Tim Laughlin. My wife and I moved to town in 2013, and I guess the best way to encapsulate that conversation is we had just been new homeowners, and we came to a school meeting, and it was about 14 months ago. As someone had mentioned before, today I stand in front of you as a parent of a three-month-old, and somebody who is looking at the region in a very different way. Thinking about the support for AgSTEM means for us thinking about how our family is going to remain within this community. To be very honest, I have had a variety of conversations with state officials at the Department of Administrative Services, the Department of Education, the Office of Policy and Management in recent days about representations of a small but vocal minority that said that they were representing my view as a resident and a taxpayer in Washington, in Roxbury and Bridgewater. I think it's clear today that that view is not the majority view. I think it's clear that we voted and we've all come to meetings, and I think it's difficult for parents to continually show up. Again, luckily, I have a three-month-old who's sleeping in the back and can really sleep anywhere, but there are a lot of folks who wanted to speak who have left the meeting today who don't, who should be at home at dinner with their families just like all of you. I would say that the process for deliberation has been extensive. What we know should be based in fact, and we know that the board presented a referendum to spend $40 million on an AgSTEM school with projections. None of us, I think in my view as young people in town, looked at that and looked at numbers. We said, yes, spend the money, build the school. I think the board thoughtfully and appropriately took an extensive amount of time to deliberate, to really get down to the number. And the projections that we've seen today, although some folks don't believe them, are baseline projections that present a conservative financial picture. The state legislative leaders today announced that in 2017 we will no longer have a budget deficit due to new revenue projections based on the corporate tax rate, that the future budget years that we'll be discussing are looking much more positive. We are on the priority list for the project. We have the support from the governors and from elected officials, and I encourage the board to move forward and make a decision. At the end of the day, I think we've heard a lot about, you know, voters' will and having another referendum. There are 2.9 million people in California right now who would like to have another election for president, but unfortunately, that's not going to take place. There was a vote, it was publicized, we talked about it, and we've been talking about it for 14 months. So at some point, we need to move forward, and I think the board should be commended, along with the administration, for everything that they've done to be as public and transparent as possible. And so it disheartens me to have accusations of fraud and deceit today, when frankly, that behavior is really indicative of some opponents who have represented the views that they have on a personal nature in ways that are not appropriate and not representative of the taxpayers of the towns of Bridgewater, Roxbury, and Washington. I encourage you to move forward, and I thank you again for your time. This is a good project. It's good for our community.
Thank you. Next is Anna Carlo. I'm sorry.
My name is Anna Carey, I'm from Roxbury. I wasn't planning on speaking tonight, so I didn't prepare anything. But I did want to bring up that my son is currently about to go into high school at Shepaug. Tomorrow we'll be meeting about his future curriculum. And I was greatly impressed with a presentation that we got in eighth grade parents to show us what Shepaug currently offers to students with the dwindling population. The teachers, the principal, they've all been very creative in coming up with ways to keep our students getting honors classes, AP classes, college credits, virtual classes online, you name it, in order to keep them up to date, needing what they need to do to get into selective colleges. On top of that, they have a dwindling population to deal with. They've come up with this creative solution where not only will they bring in students, but those students will bring money with them. And I do believe, from what I've met recently, I've learned, I have classmates, co-workers who all have gone through the AgSTEM program at Woodbury. I didn't realize how old it was, how big it is. I had a secretary at work who sent her daughters from Newtown High School because they just wanted to go to a better public school than what they had. They didn't have the money for private school, so she got them. One of them lied and said she wanted to be a florist. so she could take the courses there to be ready for college. She's now an occupational therapist. Others I know of are horse farrier, came through that program and is working in that field. I know people who own dairy farms that came through the program and are working in that field. So while they have people who want to do the agricultural, get what they want, they have people who want to go to college, want a smaller class size, want a better teaching program than what they offered in their towns, didn't have the money to do it, but could go through their own town in a public school program. Their town paid for them to send their kids to this other school, and they went. And it might not have started off very big. Over the years, it's grown and grown and grown. I do believe that if it starts off slow, it's going to keep getting bigger and bigger, because you're going to have people who can't afford private schools who are going to want their children in a program with good teachers, good education in science, technology, everything that they'll need to succeed. They learn public speaking. They learn to go to competitions. There's a lot of other training that goes on besides classroom in these programs that are life skills that they will need to succeed in college, to succeed in business, and so forth. And every single parent I've met, including a friend on Facebook from Naugatuck, her son's about to graduate from the program, went all the way from Naugatuck, is going to go on to be a doctor. I do believe that the program will help pay for itself. I do trust that these teachers will develop curriculum as they have currently. They're very creative, they're very hardworking. Every single one in that school knows my kid's name. It's a fantastic school. I believe in the teachers, I believe in this board, and I do believe that there are a lot more parents like me who can't keep their son, who's now 13, home alone all night to come to this meeting. But all those people who voted still wanted, possibly a few were afraid with the numbers. I agree the projects are always going to have numbers changing. I don't really think that's a sign that somebody was lying. I don't believe that the sign that the program isn't going to be, you know, financially stable. I just believe that's the way things happen. And if we don't move forward because of fear, we're never going to move forward. I'm the kind of person who looks at both sides and has a hard time making a decision. I'm very glad that you people made a decision, and I hope you realize that most of us who voted still want you to continue to move forward, and we really hope you do it before our kids don't have a school to go to.
Next is Anne Marie Sarbello of New Milford.
Good evening, I'm Anne Marie Sarbello, and as he said, I am from New Milford. So I am one of those families coming here who is paying tuition to come to Shepaug. So I have an interesting perspective to give to you as someone who chose to come to this district. My son in fifth grade came and visited this school and saw something special. He saw, as a fifth grader, that he was getting opportunities here that he couldn't get from his own district. As an educator myself, former classroom teacher, and literacy consultant now, I can tell you that I saw something different here and continue to do so. I will tell you also that I was recently at a New Milford party where we had several families come up to us and ask us about our experience at Shepaug, because they are considering coming to Shepaug. They wanted to know about what our experience was, and I can tell you that others have followed us in coming here. And all of the New Milford families that are paying tuition right now have a similar experience and a similar belief that I do. What we want to see is what we saw when we came here, that you are going to do what is best for students and education. I hope that you will continue to support the AgSTEM program and show us that you're going to move forward on Monday and show us that you are putting students and education first, because that's why we chose Region 15. Thank you.
Thank you. Next, I'm sorry if I miss Jason McGarry, is it?
Jason McKay.
McKay, I'm sorry, of Washington.
It's my handwriting. I went to high school in Egypt.
Can you hear me?
Oh, yeah, all right. Just want to make sure. It's not a Verizon commercial. Thank you to the board and others for all the efforts on this. Regarding the referendum, I think it's been said a couple times, it's over. The statistical gymnastics that are occurring to legitimize it is a little discouraging. We are a community, referendum's done, time to move on. I make my living in the technology arena. AgSTEM is not a fad or a facade. Data, analytics, and technology will have dramatic impacts to agriculture, and STEM skills can be applied across many vocations. Business is evolving, education needs to evolve as well. I can understand the concerns people have, but there is a cost of doing nothing. However, for those that want to continue to kick the issue of our children's education down the road, Not only will those towns lose families, it will also impact services, because like Jim, I'm also a volunteer EMT, I coach youth sports, and I'm also still with the Boy Scouts. I choose to live here. I am firmly rooted in this community of these three towns, and I will continue to raise my voice for the children and the education of this region. I implore the board, and I challenge you to have the courage to move forward. Thank you.
And last but not least, Monica Taylor of Boston Depot.
Hearing me. We appreciate the efforts that you guys are going through and all the challenges that you constantly meet. I hope you realize that we as taxpayers and citizens in the community for, well, I've been here almost 25 years now. I came here for the school over everything else, and new people who were here back then, and that's why I came. I have two graduated students. One graduated last year, and the other graduated 3 years before that. 21 and 18 year old at the same time is not fun, but they had great education here, but I can see the change that they had, and I've said this before, some people know me, I really have always supported the block schedule because I wanted our school to always look 100% unique to other schools. My effort was always, what makes us so special? Why do we want kids to come here? Instead of pulling people in that should be, you know, we're dragging them in here, we've always had people come into our school because we have special teachers, we had a special program, we have people who were copying the block schedule at other schools, New Milford, Brookfield, you know, adapting it in other ways. I went to school with the block schedule and I found it to be, you're able to take more classes that stack on top of each other when you're looking at language and math and a lot of the other technical things. It's difficult for me to think that the auto and that whole wing back there, the auto and the woodworking and the, I want to call it the drafting area because I've heard it called graphing, but that goes across many more places than just one industry. And both my girls are technical theater majors at Wagner College in Staten Island, one of the highest ranking schools for this. Nice to have them in one place. But they learned the skills of woodworking and the drafting that they had to do and all the different skills that they've had from being here. And I want, people say, your kids are graduating, why are you upset? Why are you worried about this? I belong in this town, we came here, the fireworks bring people from all areas. Most of my friends have had friends and parents and they've all come here for that. Such a great program that is here. Hate the thought that we wouldn't be able to have any more fireworks if we have farm animals here. We'd have to bus them somewhere or trailer them somewhere and bring them back after because it would be disturbing for them to be hearing that kind of thing. That was such a huge loss because a lot of people move here because they visited somebody who had it. And I always think that we have to bring the numbers here, not have people go away. The cost of the reduction of some of this program, which I do not support this program, I support anything that has education behind it and that we have great things coming in here. I want you to know that the senior projects that the kids do, our school started that in the state of Connecticut. I'm so proud to be from Washington, from the Shepaug school system. People know who we are. When my daughter was going to go to Boston University, they were telling her there was a two-year program where they would have to do hand drafting for the theater so they can speak the language with professionals. When she looked at Emerson, which she was accepted to these schools, she looked at Emerson, it was a one-year program of hand drawing. Now, the other daughter is so into the CAD system and, you know, they have all that stuff where they're at, but that would be a loss for all children in all education. Now, if the kids cannot come into that footprint of the school because the state statute says that belongs to VOAG, and you can't go in that room, then we've already lost the auto. Kids don't want to go in and get ripped off because their car broke down and they have an automotive problem and somebody's talking over their head, or they might not be able to follow what's going on. I'm one of three girls. My father raised us to be prepared regardless of sex. So we weren't treated because, oh, no, you don't have to change a tire. I changed the tire in front of my whole basketball, football team when I was in high school because my tire went flat and my education driver's ed said, no, Monica, you'll be doing this. The kids, I said, but they're all capable and it'll be done fast. And they said, you need to know how to do this. So I've always felt like every opportunity that comes up, you have to take it, grab it. You don't know when it will build for the next thing that's coming. And it feels like the number went down when the footprint left being constructed out of the school and got put in to those rooms that we had things. And I don't understand why. Also, it went down 6 million, maybe 10 or something. So that number brought itself back down. That's coming from our kids not having the auto, not having the woodworking, and not having the drawing. That part of the building will be used for other things. Some of it's already been dismembered or whatever. So that's part of that would be gone. Something else I really wanted to hit on. I understand that in the last 4 years, since we've been knowing about all this stuff coming, something contingent was the labs in the science department needed to be done, or we could not move forward with the ad stem, or whatever we were doing. Well, we've had 4 years of students that have gone through this high school without the luxury of having that lab. There's a mall, which is beautiful, but we have carpeting in the halls. We've repainted the halls where it was very independent of, this was a Shepaug school because they were painted and everybody knew, oh, that was Shepaug. And it was like, oh, that's so cool. You must be an artistic school.
Ma'am?
Yes.
Are you almost finished?
I am almost finished. Thing is, the students who have gone through the last 4 years are already missing. We may have lost numbers because the students who had that went to another school because they needed it to get into college. I just wish that was the first thing, sorry, I'm getting thirsty, the first thing that was addressed instead of making it beautiful, because the education of the students coming through, to me, is the most important thing. It can look pretty later, but right now we have to educate every student on the way through, and I hate to see that lost. I only want to see things gained for the students. And I hate the idea of losing all of that stuff. Have you hired a person who's doing any woodworking lately? It's a really good trade, and some kids wouldn't know they could do it if they didn't do it. So I just want you to think about where those numbers are saving and try to keep these programs we already have for our kids and get teachers in so other people come from other towns as well as our own and come here to be in Shepaug. And that's really what I wanted to say. Thank you.
We do have woodworking and drafting. I was wrong. Mr. David Workovan, do you want to speak, sir?
I'd love to.
Let your last. Last on the list.
Thank you. First of all, thanks everybody, the staff and the Board of Education especially, for all your time and perseverance on this project. I hope you go home here tonight feeling that this was a worthwhile evening and with more resolve to vote this project ahead on Monday. I'm a selectman in the town of Washington now, as Mr. Conway, Mr. Dorenzo, and Mr. Hubblebank was. We recently wrote a letter to Mr. Barnes in response to the quote that Valerie quoted earlier about proceeding with caution with this project rather than with a ringing endorsement. And we signed that unanimously, and we're trying to encourage them. We're very worried that this OPM and they might not push this forward as much as they want. And that's partially because the opponents here, or naysayers, whatever you want to call them, very educated, well-spoken, aggressive, intelligent group that is against this, have approached this group full force. And we have to do the same. We have to remake them. There were two points in our letter. One is that the numbers that you've come up with are, have been vetted thoroughly, and they're good. And the second is that the voices should be given proper, you know, you ought to listen to everybody, but in accordance with their proportions. Now, 69% wasn't 69% of the entire population, I know, but neither was 31%. So it's still a minority of a minority. Now, my second point I'd like to speak as an individual. I was a teacher here for 35 years, 33 of them in those science labs. So I'm at least partially responsible for them needing redoing. But I think we did a pretty good job. Mostly I'm here because, you know, I have a son and daughter that went through here. My son just spoke, but mostly we have three grandchildren coming through here. That's why we're here. And it really isn't making any difference whether this program pays for itself. We need this program to keep the school going.
All right, thank you. All right, folks, thank you very much. I want to thank everybody for coming. We do have our board meeting on Monday night, at which time the board will make a decision on whether to go forward with this project and present it to the state as best we can. Is there a motion to adjourn? All in favor? Thank you all.